The season's fresh, and so's the catch of the day when the Dodgers go fishing for marlin. Tomorrow at 4:30, live on Channel 5.
And Wayne, I'd like to present you this letter. It's not a plaque, it's just a letter that confirms that at 12:40 p.m. Eastern Daylight Time, that you officially became a member of baseball and a member of the National League. Congratulations.
Beautiful day for opening day here in Miami's Joe Robbie Stadium. Bright blue skies overhead after we had been visited with thunder showers early this morning. Hi, everybody. Welcome to today's edition of the Dodger Warm-Up Show, preceding the Game 1 of the 1993 season and Game 1 of the three-game series with the brand-new franchise, the Florida Marlins. And the weatherman has given us a beautiful day. The starting pitchers for opening day. For the Dodgers, their ace, Orel Hershiser. And for the Florida Marlins, 45-year-old Charlie Hough, who labored long in the big leagues. He's won over 200 games and spent quite a career in the Dodger organization and wearing the Dodger blue. Well, it's opening day, the beginning of 93. Opening days are always particularly exciting because you never know what's ahead of a long season. However, what we're going to do on every pregame show is look back. Because way back, there's always a magic moment in Dodger history that we would like to share with you. And so on this opening day, before we look forward to 93, we will look back to 1955. A magic moment in Dodger history in the World Series against the New York Yankees, involving, among others, the great Jackie Robinson.
This 52nd World Series we'll start in Yankee Stadium. There's nothing quite equal to the excitement of a World Series opener. The big question, will the Dodgers finally conquer their World Series jinx?
For Casey Stengel and Walter Alston, it was shake hands and come out swinging. And that's just what Carl Farrillo did, taking a Whitey Ford pitch and depositing it in the right field seats. One of five homers hit in the opening game. A couple of innings later, with Billy Martin on third and Eddie Robinson batting for Phil Rizzuto, Martin breaks for the plate. It's close, but home plate umpire Bill Summers calls him out. Billy is not amused. Top of the eighth now, and the Dodgers have Jackie Robinson on third. Would he try something? Yes. The daring Robinson heads for the plate and Yogi Berra. Safe is the call. Berra goes ballistic, but Robinson scores. An unforgettable play and a magic moment in Dodger history. Well, that was a look back at what was coming to the end of the 1955 season that would lead to the Dodgers World Championship. But today, we look down the road, the long season of 93, all kinds of questions yet to be answered. On our show today, on the menu for our pregame show, we will have a chat with Tommy Lasorda. We will talk about the Dodgers and their impact in the community. Don will have his feature of inside baseball called The Sign of the Times, and we'll have our usual baseball update. Coming up will be a visit with Tommy Lasorda. He has sure seen a lot of opening days, and we'll talk about them all coming up right after this.
The tree in front of Phil Gator's service station has been there for 73 years, a little longer than Phil himself, but not as long as his company, Unical 76. We like to think it's our unique way of caring about people and their cars that has caused us to grow. You'll find that care in our great service and specially formulated gasolines. You'll also see it in every little thing we do. Unocal 76, where you find people who care about cars.
Dave takes off on a big fishing trip. Doesn't even invite me. So I go shopping. Hope he likes it.
Super Lotto. It could happen to anybody.
We knew something was up. The foreman wanted to see us right away. They say nobody wins the lottery. Oh, yeah?
Super Lotto. It could happen to anybody.
Cold filtered, Miller Genuine Draft. For those who've discovered its smooth draft taste, the world is a very cool place.
But now I'm a man, way past 21.
Tommy Lasorda, another opening day. Do you remember your very first one?
Oh, yeah, Vinny. I can recall it like it was yesterday. I left home for the first time to go to spring training in Wilmington, Delaware. It was during the war, so we couldn't go to Florida for spring training. Train in the cold weather. And then to be shipped to Concord, North Carolina, standing out there for the national anthem opening day, I was as scared as you could be. Butterflies wondering what was going to happen to me. Was I going to be able to survive in professional baseball or not? And when you're standing there thinking about it, you say, who knows what the future holds? But by golly, here I am, 65 years old. That was when I was 17, and I'm still standing.
Let me ask you this. Anybody else on that Concord, New Hampshire team make it to the big leagues?
No, nobody.
Only one?
One guy, yeah. Of course, that, you know, that was during the war, Vinny.
Mm-hmm.
And all the good ball players were in the service, so no, none of them made it, no.
You remember your first opening day as a coach?
Yeah, I remember that. It was exciting for me, and I'll tell you why, Vinny. Because as I stood there waiting for the national anthem to be played, I looked down the line of players, and about 18 of those guys had played for me in the minor leagues. These were the same guys that I would call into my office and give them the good news that they were going to Dodger Stadium. And I would say goodbye to them and hug them and everything like that. And then here I was right there with them. So it was very, very exciting for me.
You remember your first opening day as manager of the Dodgers?
Yes, I can remember it. I can remember it real vivid, I'll tell you, because of the fact that before the game, they told me that when Don Sutton made the first pitch to get the baseball, that it was going to be sent to the Hall of Fame. He threw the first pitch to Gary Thomason, and he hit it up into the bleachers. And I looked and I said, oh, no. I said, they told me that they were going to send it. I didn't think he was going to hit that ball to Cooperstown. But that was the only run they scored. We won the game, and I got off to a good start as a manager.
And you have had a great run as a manager, and now suddenly here you are, opening day, Joe Robbie Stadium in Miami, and against you, one of your favorite people of all time, Charlie Hough.
Well, I've had a lot of guys playing for me, Vinny. Charlie Hough will have to go down in my book as one of the finest young men that has ever played for me, one of the finest young men that God ever put on earth. His family is our family, and we're very, very close. And you know something? I told Al Campanis this one day. I said, hey, don't get rid of this guy, Al. This guy's going to pitch until he's 40 years old.
Huh.
And I was wrong. He's 45 years old. He's going to pitch this game today against me. He wants to beat me so bad today.
Yeah.
I can't tell you. But I'm going to tell you something, a little secret, Vinny. He doesn't want to beat me any more than I want to beat him.
Let me ask you this. Do you remember when you first were associated with Charlie Hough?
Charlie Hough came to me as a player out of Hialeah High School here in Hialeah, Florida. And he was a first baseman, a third baseman, and a pitcher. And they wanted me to look at him and then decide what position was benefit for him. Well, I played him at first, I played him at third, and then I saw him pitch. I thought he could play third base. He had good hands. But then when I saw him run, I knew what his position had to be. He had to be a pitcher because I said this. I looked at him. I said, he's the only guy that's ever played for me. He's so slow, he could get in a race with a pregnant woman and finish third. So that's how Charlie Hough became a pitcher.
He'll be facing a much better Dodger team than the club from last year.
Much better, much better. Vinny, I'm very, very impressed with our ball club, and I'll tell you why. We have really helped our defense on the infield with Timmy Wallach at third base and Jody Reed at second. They have both played very, very impressive baseball all spring and or in the exhibition season. And then we have Eric Davison left and Darryl Strawberry in right. Two guys in the outfield that can hit the ball out of the ballpark any given time. Two guys on the corner in the infield, Eric Karras and Tim Wallach. And then the young man behind the plate, Michael Piazza. So we have five guys in this lineup, Vinny, that can hit the ball out of the ballpark with some consistency.
Well, we will see about it. This is the beginning. Have a great year.
You do the same, Vinny. And I just want to say this to start the season, that we anxiously want to give our fans a winning ball club. But to you, Vinny, and your staff, you do such a great job in bringing to the fans of Los Angeles Dodgers what is going on with the game. And we love you very much.
Bless your heart. Thank you, Tommy. We'll have more right after this.
The experts all agree. If you want to be the best in the West, the team to beat is the Atlanta Braves. Let's get busy.
Fastball is hit into deep left field. Back goes Canna, way back. It is gone. And the Dodgers have come back to take the lead.
Get ready to stop the chop when the Dodgers battle the Braves in a four-game series beginning Thursday at 4:30 live on Channel 5.
What's wrong?
Oh, the bank just turned us down again.
John and I just refinanced our home. We called 1-800-HOME-LOAN.
Who'd you call?
1-800-HOME-LOAN. They were fast, they lowered our monthly payments, and they even gave us a better rate than our own bank offered us.
The largest network of independent mortgage brokers in California. 1-800-HOME-LOAN. The only number you'll ever need to know.
Kathy, where are you going?
To call 1-800-HOME-LOAN.
California, here I come. Right back where I started from. Where bowers of flowers bloom in the sun. Each morning at dawn and bird is singing every day.
Californians have a well-deserved reputation for doing their own thing. But that doesn't stop them from doing the same thing. Getting Arrowhead Mountain spring water delivered to their home or office. You can, too, by calling 1-800-759-7332. Call right now, and you'll receive two free bottles of Arrowhead Mountain Spring Water and 1 month's free cooler rental. You'll also receive dependable delivery you can always count on. Nothing could be more convenient than having Arrowhead delivered every month straight to your door. So call now to receive your 1 month's free cooler rental and two free bottles of Arrowhead. Arrowhead Mountain Spring Water. Pure California. 1-800-759-7332.
Joe Robbie Stadium, Miami, Florida. Game one for the Florida Marlins and game one of the 1993 season. The Florida Marlins hoping to make a big impact on the community here in South Florida. The Dodgers have been making a sizable impact on the community in Southern California since way back in 1958. And one of the things the Dodgers care for is to really make an impact with the youth in the community. An annual affair is the Hollenbeck Luncheon, and we'd like to share a little bit of that with you. Over 700 people were on hand at the Bonaventure Hotel when the Hollenbeck Youth Center saluted the Dodgers and honored Los Angeles Mayor Tom Bradley. The luncheon marked the 13th anniversary of the special relationship between the Dodgers and the center. Executive Director Danny Hernandez voiced the feelings of all those at Hollenbeck.
The Dodgers, because of their ability to come down here and put together a luncheon where all the community, the civic individuals, the corporations can get together and raise the funds for our organizations to continue, it has been a tremendous partnership, and I think this is the combination of a winning team. Today we'll have Tommy Lasorda, Eric Davis, Darryl Strawberry, they'll all be here today, and they all believe that kids are a lifetime investment, and that's why they're here today.
The Hollenbeck Youth Center was established in the 1970s to provide opportunities for inner-city young people. One of the center's biggest supporters is Mayor Bradley, who was honored as Hollenbeck's Man of the Year.
I've worked with the club for as long as they've been organized, and I was involved in the securing of the Dodgers to be their great support group. And so now they turn out tremendous crowds such as we see here today. I think that the work that Denny Hernandez and all of his people do over in Hollenbeck is an example for the whole city of what can be done.
The center receives support from many areas, including the entertainment community. Arnold Schwarzenegger is a longtime backer of Hollenbeck. He's produced a film on the center and is himself a former Hollenbeck Man of the Year.
Which is an organization that really helps the inner city kids so much with their fitness and sports activities, helps them get off the streets, helps them participate and take care of their body and their mind, and therefore really raise their level of self-esteem, self-worth, discipline, and all those other things that are so important for our children. So I am a big supporter of that cause and will do everything possible to support the inner city games, support the mayor with that whole program, and other programs that he's involved with, you know, LA's Best and so on.
Dodgers Vice President Tommy Hawkins served as MC of the event, and several other members of the Dodger family were on hand to sign autographs and lend their support to a most worthy cause.
Well, it's a very important relationship, you know, to deal with Hollenbeck and to have the Dodgers here involved and have the players here supporting it is fantastic, and have the whole community get behind it and support the Dodgers and Hollenbeck is a fantastic day, and I'm just excited to be here. It's kind of a kickoff of the baseball season, gets us thinking about spring training and going out there and starting to win games.
As you might imagine, at an event such as this, tributes and testimonials come in from everywhere. Arnold had the privilege of reading one special telegram.
Hillary and I extend our heartiest congratulations and commendation to you. We hope that the next time you are in Washington, you will find the time to visit and stay with us in our new home. Again, our best wishes to you and Godspeed for the future. Your friends, Hillary and Bill Novak from Seattle, Washington.
And the Hollenbeck community, and believe me, the luncheon is very important to the Los Angeles Dodgers. Coming up, Don will take us inside baseball as we have a visit with Joe Ferguson, one of the biggest secrets in the game, the signs flashed by the third base coach. That's coming up right after this.
Whatever reasons you had for not getting cable TV, starting now, you just ran out of them. Because cable TV offers installation for $9.95 or less, plus Showtime, HBO, the Movie Channel, and Cinemax. Get big savings when you order cable and premium TV. Showtime has spectacular blockbuster movies, Basic Instinct, Hook, exclusive engagements. HBO has huge box office hits, Lethal Weapon 3, Batman Returns, big names and special events. Watch the Movie Channel for non-stop entertainment action. Bugsy and Cape Fear. Cinemax has sensational movies around the clock. Patriot Games, Stephen King's Sleepwalkers. Call now toll free and get even more. Get cable TV with 24-hour news, sports, kids shows, music videos. You'll have all the reasons for having the time of your life. Call 1-800-221-7900 and get installation for $9.95 or less when you order cable and premium TV. Call 1-800-221-7900 now.
Once upon a time, there was a small child, a big grandpa, and a golden sound storybook. The grandpa read.
And then Mickey said.
The child touched.
Gee, that's swell.
And they both laughed. There was so much to see and hear. They spent the whole day together. And the whole night, too. Golden Sound Storybooks, your child's favorite Disney stories, brought to life.
Well, hi, everybody. I'm Don Drysdale, and welcome to Inside Baseball. With me, Dodger coach Joe Ferguson.
You know that time of year again, the start of the season, and all of a sudden it's sign time. And Joe, you know, I think a lot of people out there, they hear Vin and myself talk about signs that are a little tough to get. Maybe he missed a sign or something like that. And people don't really realize what signs can be. And I think it'd be interesting for the folks at home just to give them a little idea about what a major league hitter and what a major league player has to do to think about signs, not only when they're hitting, but when they're on the bases. So I'm going to leave it up to you.
Okay, well, when third base coach is given signs, he's getting a sign from the manager. He's going to relay this sign to the player. And there's a lot of different ways, schemes that they do it, but I'll give you kind of a basic way that signs are given. If the right hand is going to be where the way the sign's going to be given, you set up certain places on your body to indicate the sign. So in other words, if the shirt is going to be, let's say, the hit and run, the leg is going to be the bunt, and the face or skin is going to be the steal, then those are your three major signs. The take is usually done with the finger, pointing the finger either down or this way, and done it so that you can kind of confuse them. But we won't get into the take. That's not an important sign. There also is a key. There has to be some type of key given before the sign is going to come so that you can at least mask these signs to the opposition. And let's say we'll use the belt as the key. So in other words, if we're going to give a sign, then the first sign after the key, after the belt, will be the sign. So if I hit the belt with my right hand, followed by a sign, that would be the bunt. Okay? Or this way would be the hit and run. Or this way would be the steal. Okay? Now, there's ways to mask. Obviously, you're not going to just hit that and that's all. You're going to be trying to mask this. So you're going to have your hands moving in all different spots before you go to the sign, so that at least it's tough to see what the sign is going to be. So there's a lot of ways to mask it. Just don't mask it so that the guy on the bases and the plate don't get the signs.
And, of course, when you're talking about masking it, he's talking about deception right there to where the opposition can't pick it up. Okay, so you're using what again? You're using this is the steal.
The right hand, this will be the key. This will be the
That's
the
your indicator.
Run.
Here's your indicator,
Here's
right?
the indicator. This is the key. The top will be the hit and run. The bottom, the leg, will be the bunt. The skin will be the steal.
Skin to skin. Okay.
The first sign after the indicator, after that key. Now, I can go to a lot of dead spots. I can go to the indicator and I can go to a dead spot, which right. means nothing. And you have to do that periodically so that they don't pick up what that key is. You can't just hit the key when you're going to give a sign. You have to hit it when you're not going to give a sign. So you go to dead areas. So the dead areas are your hat, the left side are the dead areas. So you do that from time to time and you'll do that. Or you can go like this and then to it, but that's the second thing you touch, not right. the first thing you touch. So you can confuse the opposition.
And of course, when you're talking about the indicator right there too, you're hitting it with your right hand. Now you can turn around and hit it when your left hand means nothing.
Right.
So it's basically, those are things that have gone over in the meeting, and basically the indicator, as Joe mentioned, is the belt buckle, and then your key situations of what you touch after that becomes a sign that's given.
Exactly. And if you watch a third base coach, they're not going to give you just a couple of signs. They're going to go through it. They're going to probably hit about 15 to 20 spots every time. They're going to be consistent at doing that because they want that eye, who's ever watching in the dugout, to have to work over that whole body. They don't want them just to see a couple of things touch because it'll be very easy to figure out.
Joe, if we're having a college coach or a high school coach or something out there, or maybe even Little League or wherever, anybody that uses signs, something like this, and if there's a hitter, and the hitter says, I'm not sure what he did, what should they do?
Well, they should step out of the box and come down and ask the coach.
Okay.
That's the first thing you should. If you're a coach and you look at the hitter and you see some indecision in his mind, make him step out of the box, call timeout, and go down and tell him. First of all, as soon as you see that on the base path, okay, you should call the sign off, in other words.
Right.
And
then
there's a call off of signs. A takeoff would be very simply just down the arm. But most people do that, one arm or the other. And when you do that, then that's off. And now it alerts the guy to look again. Look again,
right.
because there might be some signs coming after that. In other words, I may put a hit and run on, okay?
Mm-hmm.
And then I look and see, and the runner down there is hawking me. In other words, he keeps looking at me like, did you give it? Did you give it?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. I may call timeout, make the hitter stand out, take the sign off, okay, and put it right back on.
Now, if there's a base runner, and like you say, he's looking over there, and he might give you a nod or something like this, you know, what did you do? Will you go through the whole set of signs, or will you sometimes, I can think of the Dodger third base coach Preston Gomez, and he was a great one. He just had a little pick sign certain players.
If there's a runner at the base that's looking for something, in other words, you see him, he's looking for a steal sign. He wants to know whether he can go. There's signs that third base coach will have with certain people. That's just a touch sign, just a flash sign. In other words, a pick of the pants, an open hand, okay, the back of the hat, whatever it may be, just with that player. And so if that happens, yes, you'll see that. And it's pretty tough for the opposition because they go through all the time. When I'm going to give signs tonight, after the hitter's ready to do it, I'll start giving pick signs to the runner so that if I have to give a pick sign, they're not going to know that it's just that time.
Well, those are signs. And if you want to get deceptive, you and your coach get together at home and you really work out a good set of signs. And believe me, nobody else will be able to pick them up. So for Joe Ferguson, I'm Don Drysdale. Stay with us. We'll be right back.
Genuine draft. For those who've discovered its smooth draft taste, the world is a very cool place.
With Larry Parker Law Offices, they came to me, there was no hassle, I got all my medical bills taken care of, and a $30,000 settlement.
I was hassled by insurance companies. I called Larry H. Parker, and he got me $30,000.
If you've been injured in an auto accident, don't wait. Call me now. Toll free, 1-800-333-0000. I'm Larry H. Parker. I'm nearby and ready to fight for you. You won't have to worry about medical bills, suffering, or loss of wages.
Larry Parker got me $2.1 million.
This is delicious bacon.
I eat a lot of bacon.
Bacon, I love it.
Nice and crisp.
It's turkey.
Is it really?
Turkey?
Bacon, turkey bacon.
Lewis Rich turkey bacon.
Tastes like real good bacon.
It's half the fat by Lewis Rich.
50% less fat?
The less fat, the better.
Good point.
Now I want another bite.
Lewis Rich turkey bacon and turkey sausage.
I wouldn't eat regular bacon again.
I do like it.
The taste of bacon without all that fat.
Switch to Rich. Lewis Rich.
And how long Turk has been making bacon anyway?
Nobody does turkey like Lewis Rich.
Since this is our first look at Joe Robbie Stadium, we thought we'd take the last minute of the pregame show and take a good, careful look at this ballpark more in detail. So here it is, Joe Robbie Stadium on opening day. First of all, you can see the scoreboard atop the left field wall. If a ball is hit between the foul pole and the scoreboard and goes out, it's a home run. However, the scoreboard is in play. In order to hit a home run, you've got to hit the ball over the scoreboard into the second deck, or the ball comes back on the field. In right field, as we go all the way around, from 330 to 361 to 404 to right, right field is an umpire's nightmare. You can see the people are leaning on the right field wall, meaning they can catch balls that are hit in that area. The umpires 10 days ago asked the people to construct some kind of a fence to prevent it, but that fence is not there, and it could be a rhubarb patch throughout the season or until at least they put it up. Stay tuned for Dodger Baseball, the Dodgers and the Marlins.
Don't get the classes I want. Won't graduate on time. Can't believe they're raising tuition. This is not working. But this will. Classes I need to graduate on time, and no surprises about tuition. Works for me.
Call 1-800-942-0088. ITT Tech has 5 area campuses.
Injury Central reporting. Today's work injuries are as diverse as today's workplace. They may occur suddenly or build up over time. They can be silent, noisy, simple, or complex. For any workplace injury, call 800-529-9999. Let Injury Central help you get all your medical and monetary benefits at no cost to you. Your health, income, future, our job. Call Injury Central now, 800-529-9999.
Channel 5 News at 10. Hal Fishman, L.A.'s most trusted newsman for over 30 years. People you know, people who know L.A. Channel 5 News at 10.
Our regularly scheduled programming will not be seen today, so that we may bring you exciting Dodgers baseball next.
KGLA Sports presents Los Angeles Dodgers Baseball. Live from Joe Robbie Stadium in Miami, Florida, the Dodgers take on the Florida Marlins. Today's game is brought to you by cold-filtered Miller Genuine Draft. Get out of the old, get into the cold. By Alaska Airlines, with 21 flights to Seattle every business day. By Farmer John for the finest bacon, ham, sausage, hot dogs, luncheon meats, and fresh pork, Farmer John. A beautiful day here at Joe Robbie Stadium in Miami. Bright blue skies as we await the start of the 1993 season. Hi, everybody. Welcome to opening day and a very pleasant good day to you, wherever you may be. It has come up a beauty here in South Florida for game one of the season. Game one between two teams, one of which has been in the business since 1890, and the other will start its career today. The starting pitchers have something in common. They have both worn the Dodger blue. Orel Hershiser, a 10-game winner last year, has won 116 games in his career as a Dodger. He'll go against Charlie Hough. Charlie Hough, 7-12 last year for the Chicago White Sox. No buck fever here. Orel Hershiser has had his opening day assignments before, and he is looking for his first victory. And for Charlie Hough, the same story. The veteran knuckleballer will be on the hill for Miami. This will be his fifth start. Charlie Hough has won 202 games in his career. Orel Hershiser has won 116. So the ball given to very capable pitchers today as the Dodgers and the Florida Marlins get underway. We'll get to the starting lineup, but before we do, we want to tell you about our other telecast. First of all, we'll be right here for the first night game tomorrow night. That will be right here on Channel 5, and it'll be warm-up time at 4, game time at 4:30, and in that game, Ramon Martinez will go against Jack Armstrong. Wednesday's game, radio only, and the Dodgers then will go to Atlanta and televise all four with the Atlanta Braves, who are heavily favored not only to win the West, but to win just about everything in sight. The Dodgers come into this opening day in very good shape, physically and mentally. They concluded a very good spring training that saw no serious injuries. In fact, when you think about it, it was one of the quietest camps the Dodgers have had in many a year. The Dodgers hope that that will be reflected in good play. And let's face it, they have an opportunity to get off the season on the right foot against an expansion ball club, the Florida Marlins. But just as quickly, they will then go up against the best team perhaps in the National League, the Atlanta Braves. We'll get to the starting lineups. We'll have it all coming up for you right after this.
The tree in front of Phil Gator's service station has been there for 73 years. A little longer than Phil himself, but not as long as his company, Unical 76. We like to think it's our unique way of caring about people and their cars that has caused us to grow. You'll find that care in our great service and specially formulated gasolines. You'll also see it in every little thing we do. Unical 76, where you find people who care about cars.
If you've got a bad hairdo, who's going to come talk to you. When I go get my hair cut, I usually ask to leave it a little bit long on top and clean it up around the bottom and the edges and make like a moat that kind of curves around the back of my head and keeps me clean and tight. Now, that looks sharp. I'm ready to go.
Supercuts. How do you want your hair cut?
Excitable crowd, highly partisan crowd, and that's to be expected here at Joe Robbie Stadium as we await the start of the first Major League game. And boy, they started it off on a Major League note. Carl Barger, the late president of the ball club, had his boyhood idol come to throw out the first ball, Jolting Joe DiMaggio. So there he is, old number five, the Yankee Clipper. And that's the first sign of big leagues here in Miami. We had torrential thunderstorms, lightning, torrents of rain in the wee small hours, but that has moved through, and now it is a delightful day, beautiful blue skies in a brand new baseball stadium. Of course, Joe Robbie Stadium has been open for football for a few years, but it opens up today for the first big league game ever for keeps. The Dodgers played here a couple of years ago, an exhibition game with Baltimore. As you look around, you figure, where are all the seats in the outfield? All of those seats are covered with canvas. They are not occupied, nor do they figure to be occupied for any baseball game here. As you can see, banners and flags everywhere. But all of the seats that would be used for football, they're closed down. So when they talk about a capacity crowd here at Joe Robbie Stadium, they're talking maybe in the 40,000. Couple of ground rules we should point out to you. We should start in left field. We showed it briefly on the pregame show. That wall, the scoreboard, 220 feet long, 32 feet high, and any ball hitting that scoreboard is in play. So in order to hit a home run to left field, you got to hit it over that scoreboard. They can't call it the Blue Monster. That's the Doral Country Club. The Green Monster is up in Fenway. Right now, they're referring to the color here for the Florida Marlins as teal, T-E-A-L, not aquamarine. So we could talk about a teal curtain or a teal wall in left field. In right field, and when again we mentioned, this will be an umpire's nightmare. You can see the yellow line. Any ball hitting that yellow line would be a home run. However, there is nothing to separate the fans from that yellow line. Any ball hit to right field, you can just imagine a lot of people in the front rows will be leaning over. The umpires, when they saw that, were horrified before the start of the game. Terry Tato, Frank Pooley was saying before the game, we had asked them, Ed Vargo, the chief umpire, had asked for a wire screen of some kind to prevent the fans from interfering with the ball in play. And when they arrived at the ballpark today, much to their shock and horror, there was no screen put up. Another thing out here, there's a picnic area right there. You can come out, sit at a table, have your lunch, bring your sunblock, and take in the ball game. The dimensions, 330 down the left field line, and it goes to 361, 380, 404, 410. In fact, one little corner is a wedge in center field. That little corner is marked at 434, so it's a big ballpark. 385 in the power alley in right center and 345 to right. 434 makes that the deepest part of any park in the National League. The four umpires who have been given the responsibility of this opening day, Frank Pooley, Joe West, Charlie Williams, and Gary Darling. And now, for the first time ever, the Florida Marlins take the field in a Major League ballgame. And what a touch. Rene Lachman, who is the manager of the Florida Marlins, was once a Dodger bat boy. And on the mound for the Florida Marlins, Charlie Hough, who won 47 games in just about a 10-year period for Los Angeles. Here's the way the Dodgers will stack up against their old friend, Jose Offerman, the shortstop, and Brett Butler in center field. Darryl Strawberry in right, and Eric Davis in left. Tim Wallach will be at third base, and Eric Karros at first. Mike Piazza will be behind the plate. Jody Reed will be the second baseman, and Orel Hershiser on the mound. Charlie Hough, he is a marvel. Hough is 45 years old. He was just 45 in January. He was raised about 15 minutes from the stadium in Hialeah, Florida. Charlie's father was a prisoner of war in a Japanese prisoner of war camp for over 3 years. When his father came home, he had his two boys play baseball constantly. Rick Hough went on to study law. Charlie Hough went on to be a big league pitcher indeed. He's won 210 games, and he has pitched at least 20 games in 20 consecutive seasons. He is one of the nicest guys in the whole world and one of Tommy Lasorda's all-time favorite players. So to have Charlie Hough going after Tommy Lasorda today is a great way to open up. We can take a look at the young Marlins. Orestes Destrada at first, Red Barbary at second, Walt Weiss at short, Dave Magadan at third, Jeff Conine in left, Scott Pose in center, Junior Felix in right, Benito Santiago behind the plate, and Charlie Hough on the hill. For the Dodgers, Jose Offerman, Brett Butler, Darryl Strawberry, and now here it comes, the first pitch in Major League history here in Miami, and this crowd wild with delight and with anticipation. Strike, and we're underway in Miami. Beautiful day, capacity crowd, and the count 0-2 to Jose Offerman. Tomorrow night it'll be Ramon Martinez and Jack Armstrong. Wednesday night, Kevin Gross and Chris Hammond. You get a pretty good look at the Marlins uniform, home white with a pinstripe and that teal cap on the corner. So let it be duly noted in the minutes of the last meeting, the first pitch ever here was a strike, and the first batter struck out. Called. And now the batter will be Brett Butler, but first we'll take another look at the wobbler. Well, it looked like it was way outside, but Frank Pulley's the plate umpire, and that's all that counts. So one away, and Brett Butler coming up. Ball one. Butler, a solid year last year, a fine spring. He hit close to 300 all spring, and the count now one ball and one strike. We're just starting. Charlie Hough against the Dodgers, game one. Little foul off to the left out of play, and the count 1-2. And he's the collector of the first foul ball here. Everything is a first. Well, you can understand the enthusiasm. It doesn't seem that long ago when we opened up in the Coliseum in Los Angeles. The same fervor and the same fever here. Strike three, call. Boy, things get tough against Charlie Hough. Two down. And Darryl Strawberry, and for the Charlie Hough Marching and Chowder Society. Look at that flutter ball. And now Darryl Strawberry. Temperature in the 80s. Right. So Charlie Hough just throwing that wobble pitch all over the strike zone. Interesting, he normally has troubles throwing strikes in the first inning. One ball, one strike. Charlie with the White Sox last year, but at no time last year did Charlie Hough pitch to Carlton Fisk. That would have been a veteran battery. Oh, do they love it. 1-2 to Darryl Strawberry. Well, you know what they want. Would that be something to strike out the side? This crowd is begging for it. 1-2 to Darryl Strawberry. Amazing, this sea of emotion has surrounded the island of playing field, and a lot of the crowd standing up on the pitch by Hough. They are really into this one. Deuces wild to Darryl Strawberry. Little nubber back to the box, and Hough gets it. And if there is one surprise to me, the fact that the Dodgers did not try to bunt against a 45-year-old knuckleballer. Farmer John, the tradition continues with an economical alternative. Farmer John Fresh Roll Sauces, a masterful method for manipulating mom's marketing money. Strictly fresh, delicious corn-fed pork for the whole family. Seasoned with Farmer John's own distinctive blend of natural herbs and spices. Roll sausage, regular hot or premium roll sausage with 25% less fat. Strictly fresh roll sausage from Farmer John.
Genuine draft. For those who discovered its smooth draft taste, the world is a very cool place.
Dodgers failed to score in the first inning against Charlie Hough and the Florida Marlins. While we have a moment, let's take a look at the Marlin lineup offensively. Scott Pose in center field and Brett Barbary will be at second. Junior Felix in right field. Orestes Destrada will be at first base and Dave Magadan at third. Benito Santiago behind the plate. Jeff Conine in left field. Walt Weiss, the shortstop, and the pitcher, Charlie Hough. So it'll be Scott Pose to start it off. Pose, the 26-year-old, facing Orel Hershiser. Hershiser has won 116 games in his 10 years, winning 10 last year. He is coming off a solid spring, but all of that means nothing as he prepares to make his first pitch of the year here amidst all the sound and the fury. That's at Joe Robbie Stadium. Scott Pose was not supposed to make the ball club. They thought Chuck Carr was going to be the regular center fielder. But instead, Pose had a brilliant spring and won the opening day assignment. He hit 397 during spring training. Fouled away, and the count, one ball and one strike. Pose out of Iowa, Davenport, and lives in West Des Moines. As you wonder about what organization he came from, he came from the Cincinnati Reds. P-O-S-E, Scott Pose. Bouncer up the middle, and there's Jody Reed to short hop, and in the dirt, not in time. So Jody Reed did everything he could, but Pose, hitting left-handed, beat the throw. A long look by Cowboy Joe West before making the call. He was not about to be in any hurry.
Yeah,
Reed making his throw in the dirt, and it was beaten by Pose. So it's an infield single for Scott Pose, hit number one against Hershiser. And now the batter is Brett Barbary. Barbary earned a great deal of respect from the Dodgers when he was at Montreal. He was born in Long Beach, lives in Cerritos. He went to Gar High School, Cerritos Junior College, and eventually USC. And his dad played in the big leagues as a shortstop for, among other teams, the Reds, the White Sox, and the Dodgers. So Brett Barbary, who had about a total of 168 games in two seasons with Montreal. Scott Pose, standing at first, has stolen as many as 49 bases in the minors, so Hershiser will have to keep an eye on him. Right. Barbary was swinging the bat so well for the Montreal Expos that they moved him to third to replace Tim Wallach and put Wallach at first, and Barbary had a terrible time playing third base. So they made him eligible for the expansion draft, and here he is with Florida. Barbary, they say, is a pretty good low ball hitter, and of course Hershiser basically a sinker ball pitcher. Barbary has a chance to become a pretty good ball player, playing every day at second base, his favorite position, and for an expansion ball club. In checking the scoreboard, they have reconsidered that play, that Pose, the ground ball to Jody Reed, and they are now giving Reed an error. There's a hopper for a base hit into center field. Pose to second and holding, and so Hershiser in trouble. First and second, nobody out, and Junior Felix coming up. So Brett Barbary gets the first base hit since they took the hit away from Scott Pose. And Junior Felix coming up, who would take another look. There's a shot up the middle for a base hit. No chance to handle it. Junior Felix led the Angels last year with 36 extra base hits, but that was the lowest total to lead any team since 1976. Big story down here is just how old is Junior Felix. Some people say he's 25, others say he's a lot older. Pretty good ball player. Felix playing right field. When Felix broke into the big leagues, he became the 11th player to homer on his first pitch and the 56th player to homer in his first at-bat. He did that in 1989, and he homered against Kirk McCaskill. Junior Felix. So two on and nobody out. And the crowd beginning to chant Darryl, and he's only been here a little while. But and of course Strawberry has always said he loves to hear the crowd get on him like that, that chant, so he'll lead them in it if he feels they need encouragement. One ball and no strikes, the count to Junior Felix. Two on, nobody out. First inning, no score, and Orestes Destrada on deck. Felix had 9 home runs last year. That's a strike. One ball, one strike. Waiting his turn on deck, a home run leader in Japan, born in Cuba and grew up here in Miami, Orestes Destrada. One and two, the count to Junior Felix.
Felix on the disabled list twice last year and slumped to only 246, his lowest batting average in his career. One ball and two strikes. 2-2. Orel Hershiser struggling a little bit. We were talking about Junior Felix and the fact that his age is somewhat in dispute. They base it on weightlifting competition. And you can't be 14-year-old and be in the men's weightlifting competition. So they figure he's a little bit older. Toronto says that he was 18 when they signed him to a minor league contract in 1985. But he's from the Dominican. He could be stretching it a little. And right now he becomes the first strikeout. Now, Orestes Destrada, and what a story he is. Destrada was in the Yankee organization, but he had nowhere to go playing first base with Don Mattingly ahead of him. Then he went to Pittsburgh, and at Pittsburgh, he had Sid Bream in front of him, and he was making $75,000 a year as a backup player. So when the Cebu Lions offered him $250,000 to play in Japan, why, he jumped at it, understandably. Right. Born in Cuba, so he speaks Spanish. He speaks English. And after 3 years in Japan, he does very well speaking Japanese. So he is the tricultural Orestes Destrada. 0-1. That's in there. Strike two. 0-2 the count. So Hershiser trying to fight his way out of a jam after an error and a base hit. Struck out Felix. He has the count 0-2 on Destrada, and on deck, Dave Magadan. Magadan most recently with the New York Mets. 1-2. They're going to check at third. No swing, says Gary Darling. And the count, two balls and two strikes. Orestes Destrada, in his first year in Japan, became an instant success because he hit 32 home runs in only 83 games. Next thing you know, he was on every billboard and did a lot of advertising over there as well. Check swing, down he goes. So Destrada strikes out, two down here in the first inning. And Dave Magadan, who might be the best pure hitter on the Florida squad, coming up. Destrada really tied up on that pitch. He never does get himself free to swing. He hesitates and pays the price. So with two out and two on, Dave Magadan coming up. 30-year-old third baseman and a good hitter. He hit 283 all told last year. Hit 308 against left-handers and around 270 against right-handers. Right. His career batting average really gets your attention. That's the best since 75 behind Rod Carew, Wade Boggs, Tony Gwynn, Frank Thomas, and Kirby Puckett. So he's right up there in the high rent district. Dodgers went out in order in the first inning. Scott Pose reached on an error. Barbary singled. Felix struck out. DeStrada struck out. And now Magadan up there with the count 0-1. Ground ball to short. Hopperman quickly to Reed, and the threat is disposed of. No runs, one hit, an error, two left, and at the end of an inning, no score.
This is it. Bottom of the ninth, tie score, two out, full count. Here's the pitch. It's a fastball. And Ventura connects. A hot liner up the middle. It's still rising. Johnson leaps, and it's off the wall. He's rounding second. The ball drops. McRae scoops it up and wings it toward Pendleton. Here's the play at the plate, and he's saved. It's unbelievable. And that's the game. Now here's the wrap-up. Fleer, a game in every pack.
This is weird. It's great, but it's weird.
Super Lotto. It could happen to anybody.
I heard about it Saturday night. Next day I'm at the supermarket and it hits me. Like I could totally afford all this cheese.
Super Lotto. It could happen to anybody.
Friends, you can join the exclusive family of Dodger season ticket holders in this limited time offer for season seats throughout the stadium for as little as $486 per seat. Select from box, field, and load seats, reserve seat level, or for the first time, season tickets in the top deck and left field pavilion. Just call 213-224-1400 for information or stop by the ticket office at Dodger Stadium. Monday through Friday, 9 to 5. Ball one to Eric Davis. The Florida Marlins, owned by Wayne Huizinger. Strike. Mr. Huizinger, a longtime sports fisherman, dubbed his team the Marlins because the Marlin is a fierce fighter and an adversary that tests your mettle. There's a shot down the left field line, inside the chalk and going into the corner. So Eric Davis gets his first hit of the year, the Dodgers' first hit, and it's an extra base hit, a double into the corner. And Tim Wallach will now officially make his debut.
Third baseman, number 25, Tim Wallach.
Although the Florida Marlins are the major league team here in the Miami area, from 1956 through 1970 and from 1982 through 88, various minor league clubs in Miami carried the Marlins' name. Here is Wallach. Ball one. Wallach was right there in RBIs in the spring. He was tied for team honors with 16 ribbies. He also had three home runs. And for Wallach, another veteran, this will be his 12th straight opening day start. One and two. When Charlie Hough was first signed by the Dodgers, he was a first baseman and a third baseman and a pretty good hitter. But he couldn't run. And Tommy Lasorda decided lack of running speed but a good arm, and he made him a pitcher. Then Charlie hurt his arm, had to come up with another pitch other than a fastball, and he came up with the knuckleball that has served him so well for so long. That's lined to right, sinking, but coming up and dropping it is Junior Felix. However, Davis tries to go to third. He's out. Down to second goes Wallach. So all they really did, but it's important, is exchange a runner at second base. Still get the out. The ball should have been caught by Felix. But what happens now, there is a much slower man at second base for the Dodgers, Wallach instead of Davis. Sometimes when you throw a knuckleball, the hitter hits a knuckleball, and that's what happened, I think. And Junior Felix couldn't handle it. Davis then tried to move on, and the good throw to third got Eric easily, the tag by Magadan, and then Wallach moved over to second. So the ball should have been caught, and either way, they get an out, and the Dodgers now have Wallach at second instead of Davis. And here is Eric Karras. Ball one. Karras, rookie of the year last year, had a wonderful spring. But of course, you turn the page on spring training outside of commenting on how successful he was. Santiago takes a shot. Benito Santiago, he did not have a pass ball all last year, but his throwing suffered. He only caught 26% of attempted base dealers last year. Two and oh. Santiago trying to outthink Eric Karras. Eric might very well be allowed to swing 3-0. Mike Piazza on deck. Looking all the way. No score. Top of the second inning. Tim Wallach at second base. Sunglasses down, but it's well back in. Well, another new franchise is off and running. The Colorado Rockies opened up at Shea Stadium in New York. Their first batter, the former Dodger Eric Young. And Young is the first batter in Colorado's history. Tried to bunt for a base hit, and Mets catcher Todd Hundley threw him out. Breeze blowing from left to right. But the ballpark completely enclosed, so it will have a tendency to swirl around here. And that is ball four to put runners at first and second with one out, and Mike Piazza will be the batter.
Back in position, the catcher, number 31, Mike Piazza.
Mike Piazza coming up. His dad is here, as you can well imagine. He had an incredible spring, even though it was only spring training. A rather marvelous 478 batting average. Right. Piazza hitting seventh in the lineup. Jody Reed hitting back of him. Ground ball to third. Magadan down to second, back to first. So the double play, 5-4-3, and let that be duly noted in the opening game. No runs, a hit, an error, a man left. At the end of an inning and a half, no score.
Farmer John, the tradition continues with an economical alternative. Farmer John Fresh Roll Sauces, a masterful method for manipulating mom's marketing money. Strictly fresh, delicious corn-fed pork for the whole family. Seasoned with Farmer John's own distinctive blend of natural herbs and spices. Roll sausage, regular hot or premium roll sausage with 25% less fat. Strictly fresh roll sausage from Farmer John.
Mark Reed and the pitcher in a lot of trouble here as he looks in to get a sign. Rita is ready now, goes in.
Have you ever caught the ball at Dodger Stadium?
You know, the one that's 7.5 feet in diameter and bright orange? Well, that ball belongs to Unical 76, the company that's been pitching great gasolines and service for over 75 years. If you still haven't tried us, it's time you caught us.
And now, a word from our sponsor.
You guys are going to love this hole. Let's see what you got today. A little left to right.
Oh, ugly shot. Yeah,
don't look at it. Trust me, that is where you want to be.
Oh, yeah. The party has started.
Jesus, you right are beautiful. Like gentlemen, what'll it be?
Miller Lite.
Four? Get it? Four?
For great taste and a less filling beer, join the club.
So what's the rest of this course look like?
I have no idea.
Miller Lite. It's everything you want a beer to be.
Come on! We're going to the bottom of the second inning at Joe Robbie Stadium in Miami. A magnificent opening day. No score in the ball game. As you look, you see the lady sitting next to the gentleman in pink. That would be Terry O'Malley Seidler. On her left is Kevin O'Malley, who's a big catcher at Harvard School, and himself, Peter O'Malley, sitting on his son's left. So they make it official here in the first game ever in Miami. Line drive off the glove of Wallach. And safely aboard is Benito Santiago. So we'll wait for the scoring. We've already had two errors in the game. As Santiago hits a line drive off Wallach's glove, and the batter will be Jeff Conine. Ball was hit hard, but sitting up here, it looked like a ball that Wallach should easily catch. So Jeff Conine coming up, and no report yet officially. Ground ball wide at first by the diving Karras into right field. Santiago to second and holding. So there's no doubt that that's a base hit. And the Marlins in business, first and second, nobody out. That's what they had in the first inning. So a good piece of hitting by Jeff Conine, taking the sinker ball, barely getting it by Karras, and it almost hit Santiago. Now they're going to give Santiago a base hit. So first and second with nobody out. That's hit number three for the Marlins. And Walt Weiss, a solid shortstop, formerly with the Oakland A's. Weiss, a switch hitter, and he has done better from the left side of the plate in each of his 6 years in the major leagues. So Walt Weiss, the veteran, 29 years old, who lives in Danville, California, find Santiago at second, Conine at first, and nobody out. Line drive, just fair, down the line. So the first run will be scored by Benito Santiago. The second run by Jeff Conine as Weiss goes into third, head first. 2-0, Florida Marlins. So Wall Weiss, a triple into the right field corner to pick up two, and Charlie Hough coming up now with two in the bank. And with a runner at third, the Dodgers have to worry about a possible squeeze. 4-1. So Santiago singled off Wallach's glove. Conine bounced one by Karras, and Weiss triples into the corner to get both men home. full swing foul. As we said earlier, Charlie Hough, a former first baseman and third baseman, swings the bat well, but having spent time in the American League, Charlie might have lost his touch. We'll see. On the corner at the knees. I'll say one thing today. Frank Cooley has brought a rather large and generous strike zone to the game. Little foul off to the right, and that will go back into the crowd out of play. Orel Hershiser has allowed four hits for two runs, though it is 2-0 in favor of the Florida Marlins. Veda Pinson coaching at first for Florida, and Cookie Rojas over at third. There's Cookie. And there's Veda. Charlie way out in front of it and strikes out. The third strikeout for Orel Hershiser, and that'll bring up Scott Pose. I'm sure you've noticed it as you look at Orel Hershiser. You can see that black patch attached to his left sleeve and the number 52. That is in memory of former teammate, the late Tim Cruz, who was killed along with Steve Olin in that heartbreaking boating accident. So they're in a lot of minds and hearts today. Ground ball to the hole, base hit, and it is 3-0 Florida. So Scott Pose with the infield up, singles to left. Nice bit of hitting. They're not trying to pull him. They're just going wherever they get it. So a base hit for Pose. Three runs and five hits against Hershiser. And the batter will be Scott Barbary. Almost every time something happens, they want the ball. So that's another ball that's been tossed over to the Florida Marlins dugout. Pose getting his first hit. If they've been collecting baseballs, Pose has gotten one. Barbary has gotten one. Santiago scored the first run. He got one. Weiss knocked in the first two RBIs, so he's gotten at least one ball. One ball and no strikes to Scott Barbary. So Pose at first, Barbary at the plate. One ball and no strikes. Brett Barbary singled to center in the first inning. Ball two. So a rather unhappy beginning this opening day for Orel Hershiser. Right. Orel Hershiser started in 1987 at Houston and lost 4-3. Started 3 years ago against San Diego at Dodger Stadium and had no decision in the Dodger victory. In his first start in his career, not opening day, but just first starts, he is 2-4. Two and one to count to Brett Barbary, Junior Felix on deck. 3-0 Florida in the second inning. And there goes Pose on a drive to left. Coming up is Davis. They're decoying Pose, and the long throw to first doubles him up. And what a great throw by Eric Davis. And for a good decoy on Scott Pose at second base. And at the end of two, 3-0 Florida.
Drive to work. Drink bad coffee. Sit in dull meeting. Sit in really dull meeting. Skip lunch. Handle new crisis. Postpone vacation plans. Drive home. Not a bad day. The new GS.
Do the little things on your airline work as well as they should? Before you get on an Alaska Airlines plane, we make sure everything is shipshape, inside and out.
Trusted.
President Kennedy is
credible.
Shots from the ambassador.
LA's most award-winning newsman.
We'll have it in 30 seconds.
Okay. Record-breaking pilot.
Taxi to runway 21.
Political science professor. He brings you more than an hour of news.
Okay, let's do it.
He brings you a lifetime of experience. You've been turning to him for 30 years for the hard facts, the no-nonsense approach. As LA changes, you can depend on Hal Fishman. Channel 5 News at 10.
Marlins 3, Dodgers nothing as we go to the top of the third inning. Jody Reed, Orel Hershiser, and Jose Offerman. Another look at that great throw by Eric Davis on the ball hit by Brett Barbary. And a good decoy around second base by Offerman and by Reed. And that slowed up Scott Pose. And when he tried to get back, Eric Davis hung him out to dry with a great throw on the fly from left field all the way to Eric Karros. So the first double play turned in. Eric Davis to Eric Karros. And now here's Jody Reed. And he tries to hit a knuckleball, loses his bat. And the count, one ball and one strike. So amidst all the pomp and circumstances, all the fuss and feathers, joy reigns supreme here for the good folks in South Florida. Charlie Hough and the Florida Marlins leading the Dodgers 3-0. Boy, it is a day for the Miami Chamber of Commerce, too. Temperature in the 80s. One ball, one strike. Knuckleball dances in there. And the count, 1-2. During the games at Dodger Stadium, you will always notice Mike Brito behind home plate with a speed gun. And Mike Brito is behind home plate with a speed gun today, but what he's doing with it, I don't know. He might as well use a sundial to record the velocity of the knuckleball thrown by Charlie Hough. But anyway, just for the fun of it, he's trying to time the knuckleball, but I'm sure he's also checking out Orel Hershiser. And that will do it for Jody Reed. That's the third strikeout for Charlie Hough. And the batter now will be Orel Hershiser.
The pitcher, number 55, Orel Hershiser.
It was Jim Gilliam who first put the tail on Hoyt Wilhelm's knuckleball and called it the dancer. And Charlie Hough has a dancer indeed. 0-1. 3-0 Florida. We're in the third inning with one out. Ground ball smothered at third by Magadan, who gets up and throws him out. Nice play. So Dave Magadan takes a base hit away from Orel Hershiser. Quick reactions because he had shortened up. Orel is always a threat to bunt. And Magadan making the play on the grass. Little toe dance there by Orestes Destrada too. So a good play by Magadan. Two out in the third, and Jose Offerman at the plate. Hoverman called out on strikes in the first inning. Ball one. The count to Jose Offerman. That's ball three. 76. Florida Marlins picked up three in the second inning. Two singles, a triple by Weiss, and then a single by Scott Pose. The 3-0 Marlins. Don't forget tomorrow night, the first night game here in Florida, and that will pit Ramon Martinez and Jack Armstrong. KTLA Channel 5 will be right here. Little foul out of play. Offerman with Butler to follow. And he's aboard with a walk. For Charlie Hough, his second walk allowed, and the batter, Brett Butler. One reason I think Charlie Hough has survived the baseball wars for so long to win 202 games, he has a great sense of humor. He needed it, especially when he was with the Dodgers, when Dodger fans did not like his knuckleball and the struggles he was undergoing. I can remember he would get up in the bullpen to warm up, and we'd mention that he's throwing in the bullpen, and the crowd would boo him even though he wasn't in the game. But Charlie survived it all, and he has had a magnificent career. And they don't come any nicer. Charlie claims, while pitching in the National League, he once hit Pete Rose and Joe Morgan in the head with consecutive no-ball, two-strike pitches, and both men swung at the ball. So he says. Little foul off third, out of play. 0-2 the count. The only Dodger hit so far, a double into the left field corner by Eric Davis. Marlins 3, Dodgers nothing, top of the third, two out. And to the count. I can't be sure, but I'd be almost positive that somewhere in this vast crowd, Joe Lasorda, Tommy's wife, would be sitting with Sharon Hough, Charlie's wife. Somewhere in there. One and two the count to Brett Butler. Pitch out. Two and two the count to Brett. The deuce is wild on number 22, Brett Butler. Offerman bluffs, little ground ball to the right side. Barbary has to go back to get it and throws him out. So the Dodgers leave Offerman. And at the end of two and a half innings, it remains Marlins 3, Dodgers nothing.
I was hoping you'd say that.
Cold filtered Miller Genuine Draft. For those who've discovered its smooth draft taste, the world is a very cool place.
The Dodgers host the St. Louis Cardinals in the first three-game series of the 1993 season, and with opening day already sold out, reserve your seats early for the first two night games. Cap night, all fans in attendance receive a free Dodger blue cap, compliments of Target. There'll be lots going on when the Dodgers meet Ozzie Smith and the rest of the Cardinals. Make your ticket plans now. Dodger Baseball, the best entertainment value in town.
On April 18th, the streets of Long Beach will be missing a few things. No red lights, no limits, no speed traps. On that day, the streets belong to the Toyota Grand Prix of Long Beach. See a participating Toyota dealer today for a free super ticket. You can save up to $30 off ticket packages and score some great gifts on race day. So get into the race with super ticket savings. You'll come out the winner. See your participating Southern California Toyota dealer for your free super ticket today.
Marlins 3, Dodgers nothing. Bottom of the third inning, Junior Felix, Orestes Destrada, and Dave Magadan in that order. Full house here, many of whom wearing the Marlins chapeau for the first time. Junior Felix only walked 33 times, so he is in a very aggressive hitter. Drove in 72 runs last year. Ground ball to the right side, and that will do it for Junior. One away, and Orestes Destrada coming up.
First baseman, 39.
So here's Destrada, who struck out in the first inning. One ball and no strikes. I guess you could really talk about the Florida Marlins and use the expression "only in America," as that one is sliced into the left field corner, and that should be an extra base hit for Destrada as he doubles into the corner. And the batter will be Dave Magadan. So Destrada, a Cuban raised in the Miami area, a big favorite here, a star in Japan, and now comes back with a major league ball club.
Number 18, Dave Magadan.
Wayne Huizinger, who is the owner of the Marlins. You go back to his grandfather, who was a Dutch immigrant, who set up a garbage hauling company in Chicago in 1894. And from collecting garbage in the 1890s in Chicago, Huizinger took that over, then a waste management corporation. Then he took over Blockbuster Video. And Mr. Huizinger then purchasing the Florida Marlin franchise for $95 million. and at least another $30 million for seed money. One ball and no strikes. 3 runs, 6 hits for the Marlins. No runs, just 1 hit for the Dodgers against Charlie Hough. Magadan followed by Santiago. Ground ball to the right side to Reed. Though on the play, Magadan pulling to get Destrada over to third, and that'll bring up Benito Santiago. Santiago, embroiled in contract problems throughout his career in San Diego, signed a deal for 2 years here that should net him over $7 million. Santiago last year fractured the little finger on his right hand. That's the second time in 3 years a broken bone put him on the disabled list. And he gets a base hit to drive in a run, and it is 4-0 Florida, and they have reasons to cheer here. So Santiago is 2-for-2 with a run batted in, and the Dodgers are on the ropes early. Take another look. Fastball, and he just rams it up the middle. So that'll bring up Jeff Conine, who lives in Rialto. A little dribbler to third. Tough play for Wallach. And he throws it away. On the play, Santiago takes third. Safely aboard at first is Conine. So Wallach unable to handle a roller, and there are runners at first and third as we await the scoring again.
22, shortstop, Walt Weiss.
You can see Wallach wasn't even close to first base, so he will draw an error. It's a question of whether they are giving a base hit as well. 4-0 Florida. It's going to be a straight error, allowing Santiago to go to third. Two down. Ball one. Walt Weiss tripled into the right field corner in the second inning to drive in 2 runs. I think from the looks of the scoreboard, they are giving a base hit to Conine, and the error allowing Santiago to go to third. Meanwhile, 3-0 the count to Walt Weiss, with Charlie Hough due up next. So an uninspired performance by Orel Hershiser so far. And he's not close for ball four to load him up. And Charlie Hough with the bases loaded, leading 4-0 coming up. Ron Peronoski heading for the mound to talk to Hershiser. When the Dodgers bat in the fourth, they have Strawberry, Davis, and Wallach. The bullpens here are fenced in along the foul lines, but the crowd, the majority of whom can see into the pens when someone begins to throw. There's the Dodger bullpen, and the fellas sitting up against the wall off third base and down the line, and the Marlin pen off first down the line. And you see Cressy is on the phone, and somebody's going to get up. A little nubber. It will be Hershiser making the play, and the inning is over. However, the Marlins get a run. Don will be along in a minute. And at the end of three, 4-0 Florida. Farmer John, the tradition continues with another mouth-watering idea. Hot dogs, so fresh, firm, plump, and perfect. Dress them up to suit yourself. Meat or beef, or the ever-popular Dodger dog. Each with a rich, robust Western flavor. So very special from first bite to the last. If there are any left. Delicious hot dogs from Farmer John.
This is weird. It's great, but it's weird.
Super Lotto. It could happen to anybody.
I heard about it Saturday night. Next day I'm at the supermarket and it hits me. Like I could totally afford all this cheese.
Super Lotto. It could happen to anybody.
Well, hi, everyone. I'm Don Drysdale, along with Vince Scully. Happy that you've joined us this afternoon from Joe Robbie Stadium. Certainly a lot to cheer about if you are a Florida Marlin fan. As you could tell, coming out here to the ballpark, just a little something extra. Of course, we have been in Florida for many, many years, but the first time that they have had Major League Baseball here as a team that they can root for throughout the course of a season. And certainly the Marlins have taken hold here in 1993. They've also taken the Dodgers right by the throat as they have jumped out on top of Orel Hershiser and the Dodgers by the score of 4-0. Now here's Darryl Strawberry as we move to the fourth inning of play. Strawberry, a little tapper that Huff threw him out on his first time at bat. One ball and no strikes a count. Huff, well, he's like candy out. He puts a little on, he takes a little off. He just kind of tantalizes you with that knuckleball. If he thinks that you're timing it a little bit, he'll take a little more off. Strawberry out in front. One ball and two strikes a count. Joe Robbie Stadium, until 1993, the home of the Miami Dolphins. Now it's the home of the Dolphins and the Florida Marlins, just outside. The new crew chief of the National League behind home plate this afternoon, Mr. Frank Pulley. There's Frank. High and playable. And the left fielder, Conan, captures that one away. And that will bring out Eric Davis. We were talking here earlier with a young man out of UCLA, Eric Bresler, who is the coordinator of marketing and public relations here at Joe Robbie Stadium. And Eric was kind enough to bring us some coffee in our booth, as you could well understand, with over 600 media credentials here. As Davis takes a strike, why, things kind of went in a hurry, so we had a cup of coffee, and Eric was talking. I'm talking about Eric Bresler now, not Eric Davis, who doubled down the line his first time at bat, and the count very quickly, 0-2. I asked him, it's interesting why they covered up those seats here in the top deck. And he said, well, you know, Don, he said, the reason they did it is because there you see the plastic and over the top deck, he says they cannot see the base of the wall. So he says they're actually, they're just stymied. If the ball goes over the fence and from the wall, from where they're sitting, they cannot see the wall as far as the home plate area, as far as the outfield wall is concerned. That's out of play. And of course that makes sense. He says that, you know, you just can't have parks or seats in a ballpark that where you're going to have that kind of blind vision to know whether the ball is a home run or not a home run. So Eric said that they just decided they're going to go with the 44,000 plus and be happy with that. As Davis down on strikes, and for Charlie Hough, that is number four.
Number 25, the third baseman.
And we'll take another look at that. Good knuckleball. There's the dancer by Charlie Hough. Big swing by Davis, and that'll bring on Tim Wallach. But Eric was mentioning, as Wallach fouls that away, he said that, you know, he said 44,000 is going to be fine. He said there's not going to be a lot of day baseball here in the summertime. He asked if we'd pass along his best to his dad, Sandy, and we said we certainly would. As you see the fans, we're going to go to another section here where he says, I don't know what we're going to do. And that is the scoreboard and out in the picnic area out in deep right center field. Now, those have to come out when football comes in. And there's going to be a couple of games where you're going to have baseball followed by football. He said, now, the scoreboard's got to come out. They have to take those seats right there out. And I said, what are you going to do? He says, a very good answer. He says, I don't know. they haven't quite got that figured out yet. So, indeed, but the help of all the stadium staff here, young man that we were talking about, Eric Bresler, who is the coordinator of marketing and public relations, and indeed, they certainly deserve a pat on the back. They have done themselves proud, to say the least. That is outside. And certainly, the faculty at UCLA have to be proud of a youngster coming out of that institution, coming down here and helping coordinate a first in history as far as baseball is concerned. Southern Florida and the Dodgers will go in the top of the fourth. We go to the bottom of the fourth inning, and it remains 4-0 Florida.
When you were a child, you were told we're all created equal. But now that you're a little older, you see things a bit differently. The new Lexus GS luxury performance sedan. It's roomier, quieter, and rides smoother than cars costing thousands more. Maybe we are all created equal, but it doesn't have to stay that way. See your Southern California Lexus dealer for treatment that's unequaled.
Let's stop.
Where? There's nothing around for miles.
What about this place?
Once you've discovered great taste and less filling beer, what more could you possibly need?
Hey, buddy, what's your secret?
I don't know. Location?
Miller Lite, it's everything you want a beer to be.
The Dodgers host the defending National League East champion Pirates in a three-game series beginning with baseball card night Friday, April 16th. All youngsters 14 and under will receive a free set of baseball cards featuring the 93 Dodgers. Saturday, April 17th, all fans will receive the first of the Unical six-pin series featuring L.A. Dodger milestones. Pin number one commemorates the Major League record 12 Dodger Rookie of the Year winners. Remember, Sunday's game is a 5:05 twilight start.
That's the story as we go to the bottom of the fourth inning. Orel Hershiser and the Dodgers right now, they have a steep hill to climb. There's a couple of our gentlemen. Well, they don't have to climb any. They are on top of the totem pole as far as we're concerned. Jaime Harin, Rene Cardenas bring you all the action in Spanish on the KTLA SAP channel and on KWKW Radio 1330 AM. They are down here. They got a lot of friends down here. Of course, we have a lot of Spanish broadcasting going out of here this afternoon as Pose bounces to the second baseman, Jody Greed. And that'll bring on Brett Barbary. You know, there's some different things here in the ballpark. And we'll kind of give him a little, show you a little idea about this. Eric Bresler, I mentioned, was telling us about how they had covered the seats in the top deck. Well, there's some other interesting seats here. And you can see them right behind home plate as Barbary takes a strike. Those are the seats right there. They're in director's chairs right behind home plate. They're temporary seating. But they are $50 a game. Boy, I'll tell you. Those. Well, it's a nice place to be, I can say that. And of course, as you move back up into the seats, the first five rows, as you get into the normal seating, there's called the Founders Box. There's a bouncer again, and Reed on the big hop, and there are two outs. And that'll bring on Junior Felix. And a reminder that it'll be baseball card night at Dodger Stadium on Friday, April 16th. All children 14 years and under at the Dodger Pirate game receive a free full-color set of baseball cards featuring the 1993 Dodgers. So you can make your ticket plans by calling 213-224-1-HIT. Hope to see you at Dodger Stadium as Junior Felix stands in with two outs and the Marlin fourth inning. Felix has struck out, bounced to second. Oh, and 2 the count. See, Hershiser kind of going away from a little bit of a pitching pattern that he had. He's been really not had his good control this afternoon. Been a little wild, high out of the strike zone, especially to the left-handers. Eric Davis is there. That will take care of the Marlins here in the fourth. And through four, the Marlins lead the Dodgers 4-0.
Draft. For those who've discovered its smooth draft taste, the world is a very cool place.
But now I'm a man, way past 21.
Here's highlights from the Player All-Star Game. Hotliner up the middle. It's off the wall. McCray scoops it up and wings it to Pendleton. Here's the play at the plate. He's safe. Unbelievable. Player. A game in every pack.
When you were a child, you were told we're all created equal. But now that you're a little older, you see things a bit differently. The new Lexus GS luxury performance sedan. It's roomier, quieter, and rides smoother than cars costing thousands more. Maybe we are all created equal. But it doesn't have to stay that way. See your Southern California Lexus dealer for treatment that's unequaled.
And the Marlins leading the Dodgers by a score of 4-0. Here in the top of the fifth inning, the base hit for the Dodgers came in the second inning, a leadoff double by Eric Davis. That man, 45-year-old knuckleballing Charlie Hough, born in Brea. Spends a lot of time in Rancho Mirage, a member over at the club of Morningside. Got two good golfers here this afternoon as far as starting pitchers are concerned. Hough and Hershiser. It'll be Carlos Piazza and Reed, and we might get some action in the bullpen. Roger McDowell will get up and he will start to throw. So should we get down to that spot, pitcher spot is a fourth. The fourth hitter here in the fifth inning. I think the Dodgers right now would probably say to themselves, hey, all that we were talking about, that tongue-in-cheek, Carlos, a big swing at the knuckleball, Remember when Candiotti started against the Angels the other night, and some of them were saying, you know, with Hough, the opening day pitcher in Florida, they ought to start Candiotti against the Dodgers. Not such a wild thought, to be very honest with you. Or at least start him in an inner squad game and let somebody else pitch against the Angels. Two balls and two strikes the count. And he can't catch up to it. He didn't see that ball that well. I tell you, it's going to be interesting. We've seen a couple of the outfielders here this afternoon. They have not had good starts. You saw Junior Felix drop a ball in right field, but then he picked it up and threw Davis out going to third. That particular ball right there hit over the head of Pose. Now, that's the toughest ball for an outfielder to try and run down, one that's hit directly over your head. He did not get a good jump whatsoever. And then when he finally did go back on the ball, he had no chance to get it whatsoever. And here is Mike Piazza. So the leadoff double. And it just might be that with the fans sitting here in this ballpark, of course, those outfielders, the toughest outfield here later in the afternoon, and we're getting into that stage right now, is going to be in right field and moving across the center. Good play by Santiago. The right fielder looking due west. Piazza 0 for 1 this afternoon, hit into a double play. Bright sunshine. That's the right field, and we'll see how this fares. Tagging Karros. The catch. Look at this arm, and he's got to hurry to get there. Yeah, oh, Nelly. I'll tell you, Junior Felix uncorking that throw, and Karros could not hesitate one bit to get over there. It's a good thing it was hit. Now there, all it is right there is that extra step. He took a little time getting rid of it. He did not get in the best position to make the throw, but you could see Karros, and he's fortunate he didn't come off of that bag. Now here's Jody Reed with Hershiser on deck. McDowell throwing in the bullpen for the Dodgers, so Tommy Lasorda very easily could go to the bullpen depending on what happens here with Reed. There's this shot. A little floater. 1-1 the count. Taking a little bit off of those knuckleballs, and they're slow enough to where the fans can really just kind of get themselves all keyed up with every pitch. It's not that they missed it. There's a base hit left field, and Reed's aboard. And it looks like Hershiser is going to come up and hit for himself. And in this situation right here, it very well could be the sacrifice situation. So Jody Reed with a base hit. The Dodgers are on the board. And we'll see how Lasorda wants to play it here. Maganin is still back at third. Marlins on top 4-1. Maganin now creeping in at third. Bunt first base side, and Estrada makes the play. Does he know? He misses him going by. I do not know where the first baseman was on that ball, but they did not play that well at all. So Hershiser with a base hit, a bunt single. I do not know where Destrott, he did not come in to make the play on the ball. He did not get off of that bag in a hurry whatsoever. So some poor fielding by the Marlins here. Number one, Pose did not get a good jump on the ball to start the inning off on the double. There you can see where Hershiser was. Now he can move out of that 45-foot line. Can't go too far out of that line or they can call him out, but he didn't even do that. Here is the leadoff hitter, Jose Offerman. And all of a sudden, the Dodgers bring the tying run to home plate. And there's a base hit. They're going to wave Reed around. The throw to the plate. Not in time. Reed scores. They say that he touched home plate. He is safe. He is not out. The fans think that they call him out, but he is safe at the plate. Hershiser to second base. Say one thing about Junior Felix. He's got a good arm, but he takes a long time getting rid of the ball. And it's a 4-2 Marlin lead. See Reed coming around. The throw is up the line. Santiago cannot make the sweep tag going by. And Frank Pulley calling him safe all the way. He goes around Santiago. For a moment, I did not think that they would have any kind of a chance to score Jody Reed with the arm that we've seen with the right fielder, Junior Felix, but he just takes too much time to get rid of the ball. And here's Brett Butler. He's 0 for 2. He struck out, bounced to second. So the Dodgers now with the tying runs aboard. And you have Darryl Strawberry on deck. Owen won the count. A little bit outside, and the count goes to a ball and a strike. The big break of the inning coming on the bunt by Hershiser. Foul away. 1-2 the count. The stride of the first baseman did not break at all for the ball, and when he did, Hershiser was by him as he tried to make the tag. So instead of two outs and a man aboard, there's one out and two on as you look at the Florida first baseman. He's in on Butler. Boy, you see the sun glistening, and you see that Conine. This has got to be tough here in the sun. The outfielders all having those sunglasses down. You see the glistening coming off of the glasses, and they're all really, they're not making those catches real clean at all. Tommy Lasorda. Down in the Dodger dugout. Two outs to Strawberry. Eric Davis on deck. Atlanta leading the Cubs 1-0. Boy, there's a dandy going. Maddox and Morgan. Wrigley Field, Chicago. One ball and no strikes to Strawberry, who is tapped back to the pitcher Hough and fly to left. Pop up and Pose started back. Weiss going out and makes a catch. Oh, you talk about some short legging in that outfield. They got a break right there. So don't go away. We'll be back. 4-2 Marlins.
Mustang Sally.
Miller Genuine Draft. For those who've discovered its smooth draft taste, the world is a very cool place.
The Dodgers host the Expos in a two-game series beginning Wednesday, April 28th, with baseball bat and batting glove night. All fans 14 and under in attendance receive a free batting glove featuring the Dodger logo and a certificate for a Little League-approved baseball bat, compliments of Target. At Thursday's game, 25 lucky fans will win two round-trip tickets each to Europe via Delta, the official airlines of the Dodgers. Reserve your seats now. Dodger Baseball, the best buy in town.
Why does the florist fill up at 76? And the landscaper? Why does the plumber keep on coming back? Well, owning businesses themselves, maybe they recognize a good product when they see it, like great service and specially formulated gasolines. Maybe that's why so many businesses make it their business to pay us a visit. Unocal 76, where you find people who care about cars.
Well, that's the story as we go to the bottom of the fifth inning. 4-2, the Florida Marlins on top. And, of course, in between innings, why, there you see Billy the Billfish. Fort Lauderdale, spring break, and what more would you expect? That's what they call him. That's the mascot's name, Billy the Billfish. Of course, Orel Hershiser could care whether it's Billy the Billfish or not. He'd like to see Rudy the Runs. That's what he'd like to see right now. As we go to the bottom of the fifth inning, Dodgers got two runs back, 4-2 Florida. And that'll bring on DeStrada, followed by Maganin, and then Santiago. There's the strike, and the count is 0-1. DeStrada struck out, doubled, and scored. Estrada last year at Cebu, playing in Japan, hit 41 home runs and drove in 87. We have about three Japanese crews here that are covering this game this afternoon, along with a lot of people from Latin America. As Dave Maganin stands in, some of your cameramen. And the strike to Maganin, 0-1. Maganin is 0-2. Little tapper, Hershiser will handle that. Two outs to Santiago. Well, Texas jumped on top of Baltimore 5-1, but the Birds came back and scored three in the fourth, and after four at Baltimore, Camden Yards, Texas 5, Baltimore 4. And the Yankees on top of the Indians at Cleveland by a score of 7-1, as you look at Rene Latchman down there looking at that scorecard. Wallach on across to Carlos in an easy 1-2-3 inning. We go now to the sixth inning. It's the Dodgers trailing the Marlins 4-2.
The tradition continues with another bright idea to make your morning and your day. Farmer John bacon sizzling hot in the frying pan with that truly great smoke hearty western flavor. Farmer John bacon, adding wake up goodness to the start of a perfect day. a sizzling great way to wake up every day. Easternmost in quality and the westernmost in flavor. Bring home the bacon from Farmer John.
Joe Robbie Stadium, the Florida Marlins, the Los Angeles Dodgers in Dodger baseball, and we certainly want to pass along our best to all the crew and management back at KTLA Channel 5 watching today's game on Stage 8. Don't worry about us, guys. You just have a good time, and we'll try and get along the best we can. As the Marlins lead the Dodgers by a score of 4-2. Orel Hershiser has thrown 52 pitches while Charlie Hough has thrown 76 through the first five innings of play. And in the sixth inning, it'll be Davis, Wallach, and Karros in that order. Kansas City leading the Red Sox 1-0. That's in the bottom of the fourth inning at Royal Stadium in Kansas City. Colorado and the Mets, no score. That's after three, while Cincinnati shutting out Montreal 2-0 after five. Pops him up. We'll see who's going to try that one. There goes Weiss again, and he will make the catch. Boy, I'll say one thing. Somebody is going to get together if they've got an outfield instructor, and that very well could be Vada Pinson. He's going to get together with his outfielders and say, hey, guys, you know, give those infielders a little help. It's a lot easier for you coming in than them backpedaling going out. So one pitch and one out. And that'll bring on Tim Wallach. Wallach this afternoon has been on in air. And he bounced the third 0-2. Two strikes to count. Ball, two strikes, one out, and we're in the top of the sixth inning. Marlins leading the Dodgers 4-2. Dodgers with another game coming your way tomorrow night on KTLA Channel 5. Foul away. Count remains 1-2. Then they will finish out the series here on Wednesday night, radio only, and they will be moving into Georgia. All four games with the Braves on radio and television. Two balls and two strikes at count. Tim Wallach. Oh, mercy, that ball was hit. That went all the way up into the top deck. And it's a 4-3 ball game, and Wallach is on the board with his first home run of the year, his first home run as a Dodger. And there's the young man who has the baseball. And if we pull back from where he's at, you'll see how far up he is. It's way up in the top deck where they had the seats covered. So it's a 4-3 ball game. And Eric Carroll standing in. And that's one of the things that Tommy Lasorda has said this year. He said, we've got some guys in that lineup. One swing of the bat, we can score a bunch of runs, or we can get back in the ball game in a hurry. And on that home run. The Unocal Company pleased to present a $50 book of Unocal Auto Script to the YMCA in Santa Ana, Tustin. There's the strike. A little bit inside. Two balls and a strike. Well, one swing of the bat indeed, and the Dodgers can even this game up. 4-3, Florida. Off the hands, down the left field line, and there is Conine to make the catch. And that'll bring on Mike Piazza. Carlos jammed himself. On deck, Jody Reed. Joe Klink starting to throw in the bullpen for the Florida Marlins left-hander. One ball and no strikes to Piazza's hit into a double play, and he's flying to right. One ball and one strike to count. When you look at the Dodger lineup from Strawberry to Davis to Wallach to Carroll to Piazza, there are five guys right there with a swing of the bat, and they can go deep on you. Two balls and a strike. Boy, what a storybook career it has been for that young man, Mike Piazza. To the hole, Weiss, good glove, and he got him. So the Dodgers gone, but they pick up a run on the home run by Wallach. We go to the bottom of the sixth inning. It's the Marlins 4 and the Dodgers 3.
Mark Reed, the pitcher, in a lot of trouble here as he looks in to get a sign. Rita is ready now.
Have you ever caught the ball at Dodger Stadium? You know, the one that's 7.5 feet in diameter and bright orange? Well, that ball belongs to Unocal 76, the company that's been pitching great gasolines and service for over 75 years. If you still haven't tried us, it's time you caught us.
And now, a word from our sponsor.
Dave takes off on a big fishing trip. Doesn't even invite me. So I go shopping. Hope he likes it.
Super Lotto. It could happen to anybody.
We knew something was up. The foreman wanted to see us right away. They say nobody wins the lottery? Oh, yeah?
Super Lotto. It could happen to anybody.
Channel 5 News at 10. Jan Carl, part of L.A.'s most experienced news team. People you know, people who know L.A. Channel 5 News at 10.
Well, a reminder that on Saturday, April 17th, that'll be Unocal pin number one night with all fans at the Dodger Pirate game receiving a free pin saluting the 12 Dodger Rookie of the Year winners from Jackie Robinson to Eric Carroll. So a great collector's item. So we hope you make your plans by calling 213-224-1-HIT. Here in the bottom of the sixth inning, it'll be Jeff Conine to lead it off. Curveball way high. That curveball just got away from Hershiser. Conine's 2-for-2. And Luis Aquino, a right-hander, gets up to join Joe Klink, the left-hander. That's the right center. Strawberry over. So Conine is 3-for-3. And it's hit number 10 for the Marlins this afternoon. As you look at the pitchers, Aquino, the right-hander, coming over from the Kansas City Royals. And Joe Klink and Walt Weiss will step in. Weiss has tripled and walked. And now you've got McDowell and Wilson getting up in a hurry in the Dodger bullpen. Warm afternoon here at Joe Robbie. I don't know how much air and circulation there is down there in the field. The runner going by the diving read. Base hit on the hit and run to third is Conine. Runners at first and third, and nobody out for the Marlins. And we're going to see what's going to happen as far as the Marlins are concerned. On that hit and run, Reed was not covering, but Weiss able to pull it into the hole. By the time Strawberry gets it back in, Weiss at first, Conine at third. We're going to have a pinch hitter.
Ladies and gentlemen, for the Marlins,
Alex Arias.
Is number 24, Alex Arias.
So Alex Arias will come up and he will hit for Charlie Hough. Arias is an infielder from New York. Born in New York, makes his home in New York City. He's a 6'3", 185-pounder. Last year, with the Chicago Cubs, hit .293 in 32 ball games. At Iowa, he hit .279. Roger McDowell, and it looks as though he will sit down, possibly. Steve Wilson, nope, he's going to come on in. They're going to relieve him. And that's going to be all for Hershiser as they will make the pitching change. So we'll be back. Winners at first and third. Bottom of the sixth. 4-3 Florida.
The tree in front of Phil Gator's service station has been there for 73 years. A little longer than Phil himself, but not as long as his company, Unical 76. We like to think it's our unique way of caring about people and their cars that has caused us to grow. You'll find that care in our great service and specially formulated gasolines. You'll also see it in every little thing we do. Unical 76, where you find people who care about cars.
Roger McDowell coming on. That's the story as the Marlins threaten again here in the bottom of the sixth inning. They have chased Orel Hershiser. Runners at first and third and nobody out. Roger McDowell last year for the Dodgers in 65 ball games, a record of 6 wins, 10 losses, an earned run average of 4.09, and he had 14 saves on the year. So McDowell on in relief of Hershiser, the veteran right-hander. Asked to turn the Marlins away. Tommy Lasorda, Joey Amalfitano pointing, Joe Ferguson on the other side. You see what Amalfitano was saying. He's crossing his arms, telling somebody, telling Offerman halfway. That's what he will be telling Offerman. That's what the arms crossed in eight, make that 7 ball games this spring. McDowell had a record of 1-1. With a 6.17 ERA. He worked in 11 and two-thirds innings, allowed 8 runs all earned. There are the Marlins with runners at first and third, and Arias the hitter. Ricky Trilcheck and Steve Wilson throwing in the bullpen. McDowell ready to go to work. There's the strike. Trilcheck Drilcik the right-hander and Wilson the left-hander. Fouled at the plate and the count is 0-2. Scott Poe is the leadoff hitter on deck. See right there, career with the Dodgers. Runners that have been stranded for McDowell. And Roger trying to do that job some more. A ball and two strikes it count. Arias checking with his third base coach, Cookie Rojas. Boy, Cookie's happy to be here with Florida. There he is. I'll tell you one thing, there was a good ball player, Cookie Rojas. Outside and the count 2-2. Cookie making his home down here in Miami. With the Philadelphia Phillies, they always tongue-in-cheek. Bobby Wine, now a scout with the Atlanta Braves, to talk about the days of Wine and Rojas. 2-2 the count. Runners at first and third, nobody out. And Florida on top, 4-3. Back to McDowell. He goes to second base, and that's all they can get. Well, there was a play where Florida got a break. The Dodgers really didn't get much of a break. Many times you'll tell that runner at third with a ball hit, you go to stay out of the double play, but with McDowell forcing and showing that runner back, now he goes to second base, they can only get one, and that's all. They can't get the double play. So there's still runners at first and third, and now one out. Here's Scott Poe as the center fielder. Shortstop, and that's all, a bad throw. They had an easy double play ball, and Offerman could not get himself righted to make the play. So McDowell comes on and throws two comebackers, and the Marlins pick up a run. A tough break for the Dodgers.
Second baseman Brett Offerman. He's
got time. He's still concerned with that runner at third, but now he goes back to Offerman, who cannot make the play at first base. The run scores. So you'll give Pose an RBI. It's a 5-3 Florida lead. Dow got to be a little bit unhappy with himself right there. As Brett Barbary stands in, he is 1-for-3 this afternoon. Keep an eye on Pose at first. Junior Felix on deck. There's a strike and the count is 0-1. So the Dodgers draw to within one with a home run by Wallach in the top of the inning, and the Marlins come back and get one here thus far in the bottom of the inning. Checking with Rojas at third. There goes the runner. Pitch inside. Throw through. They get him. So Poe's cut down. Piazza to Offerman. Vin will be back with you in the seventh inning through six. 5-3 Florida.
Mm-hmm. Where there's smoke, there's chicken. At Jack in the Box, we slowly smoke chicken breast and carve it into tender slices. And where there's smoked chicken, there's cheddar. Natural aged melting cheddar. Then we top it with sizzling bacon, all on grilled sourdough. The new smoked chicken cheddar and bacon sandwich at Jack in the Box. Where there's smoked chicken, there's
The art of brewing is about control.
Controlling the process, the quality of the ingredients.
Every little detail.
That's how we bring you a great beer.
Well, once it leaves here,
you're the one in control.
We want you to enjoy our beer.
At a ball game.
A barbecue.
At dinner with the family.
After work with friends.
But please, drink responsibly. Remember, friends know when to say when.
We'd all appreciate it.
A reminder from the people who bring you Budweiser.
Flying the Red Eye. Lousy movie. Rough landing. Lost luggage. Long walk to airport parking. On-ramp to highway. Suddenly, traveling's not so bad. The new GS.
Hi once again, everybody. Before the game started, Tommy Lasorda was saying his dream would be that his good friend Charlie Hough would shut out the Dodgers, Orel Hershiser would shut out the Marlins. In the eighth inning, they would bat for Hough so he'd be out of it, and the Dodgers then would score a bunch and win it. Well, that part has not worked. Charlie Hough is out of it, but the Marlins are leading 5-3. Hershiser is also gone, and we go to the seventh inning as the Dodgers will face Luis Aquino coming out of the Florida bullpen.
Now pitching, number 27, Luis Aquino. Aquino, now pitching.
The Luis Aquino will pick up to do the pitching, and Charlie Hough gave the Marlins six innings and goes out leading 5-3. Aquino with Kansas City. Jody Reed starting it off. One ball and no strikes. And that's a base hit, so the Dodgers trying to come back. They were down 4-0, got it close 4-3. Now it's 5-3. And Lenny Harris will come up and bat for Roger McDowell.
Lenny Harris. Harris, the Dodgers hitter.
Dodgers had three runs and six hits against Charlie Hough. And now they get a base hit against Aquino. Santiago out to talk to the right-hander. Rene Latchman, the manager, now coming out to talk to Aquino. One of the reasons, one of many reasons, why Rene Latchman got the job is because he speaks Spanish fluently. His brother Marcel is the pitching coach. And now Joe Klink will be coming in from the bullpen. Klink, a left-hander. But Klink relieves Aquino, and we'll have a lot more after this. Farmer John, the tradition continues with an economical alternative. Farmer John Fresh Roll Sausage, a masterful method for manipulating mom's marketing money. Strictly fresh, delicious corn-fed pork for the whole family. Seasoned with Farmer John's own distinctive blend of natural herbs and spices. Roll sausage, regular hot or premium roll sausage with 25% less fat. Strictly Fresh Roll Sausage from Farmer John.
Drive to work, drink bad coffee, sit in dull meeting, sit in really dull meeting, skip lunch, handle new crisis, postpone vacation plans, drive home. Not a bad day. The new GS.
With left-hander Joe Klink being called out of the Marlin bullpen, the Dodgers make a change, and Corey Snyder will now come up and bat for Lenny Harris. Joe Klink, an interesting study, 31 years old, out of Johnstown, Pennsylvania. He has returned to Miami. He's had all kinds of experience. Klink pitched for Oakland in the 1990 World Series against Cincinnati.
Corey Snyder. Snyder is the Dodger pinch hitter.
So Corey Snyder will be the batter against Joe Klink. So another local son, Joe Klink pitching to Corey Snyder. And the scouting report tells you Snyder likes that first pitch. 0-1. Klink has never owned a house outside of South Florida. He was born in nearby Hollywood, Florida. He pitched at St. Thomas University, married a girl from South Broward High School, and he still lives near Hollywood Boulevard in Florida. 1-1. Klink had quite a battle to make the ball club because the Marlins had five left-handers for two spots in the bullpen. Ground ball to the hole at short. Weiss back to get it, and they'll get the force play. Chris Carpenter gets up and begins to loosen up in the Marlin bullpen. And the Dodgers will have the leadoff man, Jose Offerman, coming up. Had McDowell led Offerman on that second comebacker in the sixth inning, the Dodgers probably would have gotten the double play. But McDowell threw behind Offerman, and he couldn't get the ball out of the glove after spearing it in the webbing. And that cost a run. One ball and no strikes to Jose Offerman. And that got away, but holding it first is Snyder, and Santiago almost threw the ball into center field. That was a great save by Brett Barbary. And Snyder holding. Take another look. Watch Santiago gun it and watch Barbary save the day. Nice play by Brett. When Rene Latchman was the third base coach for Oakland, Klink was a pitcher with the A's, so that's the connection. There's a fly ball to center and deep. Pose going back to the deepest part of the ballpark and makes the over-the-shoulder catch. And Snyder back to first. I really didn't think Offerman could hit a ball that far. Scott Pose goes to deep center to make a fine catch on a ball hit by Jose Offerman. Boy, did he hit that thing a long way. And Pose just did spear it, and look at that sign. It's 434 in the corner. So Offerman hit it a ton, but it's just an out. Nice play. He took the job away from Chuck Carr, who's supposed to be an outstanding defensive player, but Chuck couldn't have made a better play. 0-1 to count to Butler. Struck out, grounded out, flied out. Two down in the seventh. 5-3 Florida. Not in time at first. Santiago likes to take shots at the runners with that great arm of his. And especially is he dangerous with a runner at first and a left-hand batter. He uses that left-hand batter like a screen and fires from his knees. Oh, and two to Butler. Swung at it, missed, lost his bat, and with a red face walks away. So thanks to Pose, the Dodgers are turned away. And at the end of 6.5, 5-3 Marlins.
Knock yourself out just getting to your flight. That's why at Alaska Airlines, we figured the least we can do is treat you well once you finally get here.
Catching a Dodger game at Dodger Stadium is a great family entertainment value. With $6 top deck and pavilion seats, a family of four can attend a game for just $18. By purchasing $3 general admission tickets for youngsters 12 and under at Dodger Stadium an hour and a half before game time. Field box and load seats only $11. Reserve seat level just $8. Purchase advance tickets at Dodger Ticket Outlets or by calling 213-224-1-HIT.
As LA changes, news anchors come and go. That's why you turn to Channel 5's Hal Fishman. He's been dependable for 30 years. You feel earthquakes and see fires, and when you need the facts, you know Hal Fishman has more than anyone else. That's why more Southern Californians turn to Channel 5 when important news hits L.A.
Good evening.
News anchors come and go every day. But as L.A. changes, you can depend on Hal Fishman. Channel 5 News at 10.
The Marlins leading all day lead the Dodgers 5-3 in the bottom of the seventh inning. Rick Trilcheck will pick up and pitch to Brett Barbary, Junior Felix, and then Orestes Destrada. So it's been Hershiser, McDowell, and now Trilcheck.
For the Dodgers, outfit number 26, Rick Trilcheck.
So Trilcheck working on Barbary. Brett Barbary single to center, fly to left, grounded out, 1-for-3. 5 runs, 10 hits, and 1 error for Florida. 3 runs, 7 hits, and 2 errors for the Dodgers. Strike. Trilcheck picked up by the Dodgers on a look-see basis and has fought his way to a job. Another strike. 0-2. Just by the diving Jody Reed, and it's a single to right for Barbary. So that's his second hit. In the lineup, Junior Felix and Dave Magadan are without a hit, along with a pitcher. Everybody else has at least one. Junior Felix, 0-for-3. Felix struck out, grounded out, and fly Derek Davis deep in left field. They're going to check and swing, says Gary Darling. One. 5 runs, 11 hits for Florida. 3 runs, 6 hits, 2 errors for the Dodgers. Doubles by Davis and Karros, and a home run by Wallach. The Marlins had a triple by Weiss and a double by DeStrada so far. Ground ball into right field. So Barbary is on his way to third. That's a dozen hits for the Marlins. First and third, nobody out, and Orestes DeStrada coming up. So they had 5 runs and 10 hits against Hershiser. They now have 2 hits against Trilcheck. DeStrada, Magadan, and Santiago coming up. There's a hopper to Reed. They'll get one and they'll get two, but they pay a price and give up a run. And Florida now leads 6-3. DeStrada does not get a run batted in.
Third base,
6-3 in favor of Florida, and Dave Maggott in the batter. When the Dodgers hit in the 8th inning, they'll have Darryl Strawberry, Eric Davis, and Tim Wallach. Ball one. Tomorrow night, Ramon Martinez and Jack Armstrong. Warm-up time at 4 o'clock and game time 4:30. Right here on Channel 5. So we'll see how Ramon goes against Jack Armstrong. That's the matchup tomorrow evening. And there's another base hit. So Magadan singles to center. And now everybody in the starting lineup has a base hit for the Marlins except the pitcher spot.
Catcher,
6 runs and 13 hits for Florida. And Benito Santiago, 2-for-3 coming up. Look out. Well, Santiago loses the bat. Among others down there, Tom Goodwin just did get out of the way of it. Oh and one to Santiago. 2 out, Magadan at first. 6-3 in favor of Florida. Foul back. 0-2. Well, the Marlins, twice as many runs, almost twice as many hits. They have 13 hits to the Dodgers, 7. Much to the delight of this sellout crowd, 43,909. When they play football here, the capacity crowd is 73,000. But they close off all the seats in the upper deck that are used for football, and consequently, attendance falls off by 30,000 when you come to baseball versus football. And all those banners out there for all the world look like a Spanish armada, a flotilla, with the sails flapping in the breeze. Little fly ball to Strawberry.
Yeah.
One run, three hits, a man left, and at the end of seven, 6-3 Marlins.
On April 18th, the streets of Long Beach will be missing a few things. No red lights, no limits, no speed traps. On that day, the streets belong to the Toyota Grand Prix of Long Beach. See a participating Toyota dealer today for a free super ticket. You can save up to $30 off ticket packages and score some great gifts on race day. So get into the race with super ticket savings. You'll come out the winner. See a participating Southern California Toyota dealer for your free super ticket today.
They're the most skillful predators on Earth. They have teeth like razors. They can smell a few drops of blood up to a mile away. And now you can be there with them. They're waiting for you.
Farmer John, the tradition continues with a half a dozen great ideas. Corn dogs from Farmer John. Six premium meat or beef corn dogs in a full 1 pound tray. Each corn dog starts with a Farmer John meat wiener or beef frank, covered with a distinctly delicious blend of sweet golden cornmeal and cooked to perfection. They're oven or microwave ready for truly convenient serving. Meat or beef corn dogs, a half dozen great ones from the tradition that is Farmer John.
This copyrighted telecast presented by authority of the Los Angeles Dodgers Incorporated, which also employs the announcers, and is intended solely for the private non-commercial use of our audience. Any publication, reproduction, retransmission, or other use of the pictures, descriptions, and accounts of this game without the express written consent of the Los Angeles Dodgers Incorporated is prohibited. Tommy Lasorda and company slowly running out of time as they go to the eighth inning. It is 6-3 in favor of the Florida Marlins. Darryl Strawberry, Eric Davis, and Tim Wallach in that order. Strawberry hit back to the box, fly to left, popped to short. Darryl had a chance. He had one big at-bat with two on and two out in the fifth, but he popped up. 2-0. Now it's 3-0. On deck, Eric Davis. It was 4-0 in favor of the Marlins, then 4-2, 4-3, then 5-3, and now 6-3. So the Dodgers have been trying to play catch up all day. 3-1. That's ball four. So the Dodgers get a leadoff man aboard. And the batter is Eric Davis, and Renee Latchman coming out to talk to Frank Pooley. We'll see if he's going to make a 2-for-1 switch, and I believe so. Jeff Conine is trotting in from left field, so let's see. Chris Carpenter has been throwing in the bullpen. Conine comes in to get a glove, and Orestes Destrada comes out of the game, and Conine will play first base. We'll have to get an outfielder. Chuck Carr will go into center, and Scott Pose will move to left. And with Carpenter slowly walking in from the bullpen, we have plenty of time for this.
The tree in front of Phil Gator's service station has been there for 73 years. A little longer than Phil himself, but not as long as his company. Unical 76. We like to think it's our unique way of caring about people and their cars that has caused us to grow. You'll find that care in our great service and specially formulated gasolines. You'll also see it in every little thing we do. Unical 76, where you find people who care about cars.
Marlins leading the Dodgers 6-3, and Florida making several changes. Scott Pose, who had been in center field, moves over to left. Chuck Carr comes in to play center field. Jeff Conine, who had been in left field, will pick up at first base. And on the mound, Chris Carpenter. Now, if you're keeping score with us, I would assume that Chuck Carr would bat eighth and therefore bat third when the Marlins come up in the eighth inning. And Carpenter would go in Orestes Destrada's spot. Carpenter, last year for most of 92, built on his success of 91. And he was picked 19th in the Marlin expansion draft. He was in 73 games last year with the Cardinals.
33.
But he pitched no more than two innings, only three times. The big problem for Carpenter, he gives up the home run ball. Ball one. Last year, he allowed 10 home runs. And in those games where he allowed the 10 home runs, the Cardinals lost 9 of the games. He has the luxury of a 3-run lead. Strike. Down in the bullpen, Brian Harvey, who's the closer, tuning up. Carpenter, a good fielding pitcher, did not commit an error last year. Ground ball foul off Davis' foot. So no play. I don't think the crowd realized that the ball hit Davis on the foot. Eric today doubled, struck out, and popped up. So 28-year-old Chris Carpenter, the setup man, last year for Lee Smith and this year Brian Harvey. 2-2. Six to three in favor of the Marlins. We're in the eighth inning. Missing, and he goes 3-2 to Davis. On deck, Tim Wallach, who hit one upstairs his last at bat. Three and two. Popped in the air foul off first base. Conine and Santiago take a look, but it's well back in amongst the customers. 43,909, a sellout for a stadium that holds 73,000 for football. Boy, what a gem of a day we had after a huge storm last night and early this morning. 3-2 to Eric Davis. Check swing, a sprawling stop by Carpenter to get him. So Eric Davis might have hit ball four. Strawberry advances to second, and with one out, Tim Wallach, the batter. Pitch in there, and he tried to hold up. Nice play by Carpenter to get him. Rene Latchman is going out now with Wallach, the batter, and let's see. They're checking Carpenter to make sure he's all right after that diving stop. Rene Latchman, along with his brother Marcel, Marcel the pitching coach, brothers were partners and battery mates in the minor leagues. Well, Carpenter obviously okay. Here is Wallach, reached on an error by Junior Felix in right field, rounded to third, and hit one upstairs, top deck. That's a monstrous wallop here. Marlins 6, Dodgers 3, one out in the eighth inning. Eric Karros on deck. Strawberry at second. One and one. There's Eric, and he's followed by Mike Piazza. Assorted, trying to talk the Dodgers back into the game. One and one. Marlins have led all game, 3-0, 4-0, 4-2, 4-3, 5-3, and now 6-3. Good changeup. Wow, and Wallach way out in front of it. That was a great pitch by Chris Carpenter. Fans, a little hand clapping. Two and two. Tomorrow night, Ramon Martinez and Jack Armstrong. Wednesday night, Kevin Gross and Chris Hammond. And then it'll be on to Atlanta. Two and two. On the fists. Tim Wallach, and with two down, the batter is Eric Karros. Eric Karros walked in the second inning, doubled and scored a run in the fifth, flied to left in the sixth. Six runs, 13 hits for the Marlins, three runs, seven hits for the Dodgers. Strike. Right. and the prospects of Brian Harvey pitching the ninth inning for the Florida Marlins. Another strike. Six, Dodgers three in the eighth inning with two out. Fouled away, upstairs, out of play. Rene Latchman so close to his first victory as the Marlin manager. Chris Carpenter, a great all-around athlete at the University of Georgia. He was not only an All-American in baseball, he was an outstanding punter. He was honorable mention as a punter for the university. He was all Southeast Conference. One ball and two strikes, Derek Karros. And there's a hopper to the right side. Brett Barbary over to Jeff Conine. And the Dodgers are down to their last inning at the end of 7.5. 6-3 Marlins.
I liked Marjorie the first day I laid eyes on her.
He was romantic even then. We started going together when we were 15.
Times were tough.
But we barely noticed.
We were married during the war.
I thought he looked handsome in a uniform.
She was right. 3 days ago, we celebrated our 50th anniversary.
He's still romantic.
Drive to work. Drink bad coffee. Sit in dull meeting. Sit in really dull meeting. Skip lunch. Handle new crisis. Postpone vacation plans. Drive home. Not a bad day. The new GS.
Farmer John, the tradition continues with another mouth-watering idea. Hot dogs, so fresh, firm, plump, and perfect. Dress them up to suit yourself. Meat or beef, or the ever-popular Dodger dog. Each with a rich, robust Western flavor. So very special from first bite to the last. If there are any left. Delicious hot dogs from Farmer John.
Don't forget, you can get season tickets by calling 224-1400. You can also explore season tickets in box field and load seats, reserved level in the top deck and the left field pavilion. Here's Jeff Conine, the first baseman. And he promptly comes up with a 14th base hit for the Florida Marlins and his fourth hit. So what a way to break in with a new franchise for Jeff Conine to go 4-for-4. The fourth hit allowed by Trilcheck. And Walt Weiss, the shortstop, coming up. Chuck Carr, by the way, the center fielder, is batting ninth. Weiss has a walk, a single, and a triple. The bunt foul to the screen, and the count 0-1. The Dodgers have used Hershiser, McDowell, and Trilcheck. Five runs charged to Hershiser. Charlie Hough, then Luis Aquino, Joe Klink, and Chris Carpenter. The pitchers of record right now are Hough to win and Hershiser to lose. When the Dodgers bat in the ninth inning, they'll have Mike Piazza, Jody Reed, and a hitter for Trilcheck. Weiss checking with Cookie Rojas. Konine at first. Scoreboard and looking out there in right center, the Mets are leading Colorado 2-0 at the end of six innings. So the other new franchise in the National League, the Colorado Rockies. Here's Cookie Rojas. And the crowd, with nothing else to do, decides they'll get on Darryl Strawberry with the chant. He stuck his tongue out. Now kisses. There goes the runner, hit and run ground ball to third. Wallach's only play is to first. So they put the hit and run play on and stay out of the double play. And the batter now will be Chuck Carr, the center fielder.
Number 21. Chuck Carr.
Most people down here thought he was going to be the opening day center fielder, but he wasn't hitting very much. And meanwhile, Scott Pose was tearing up spring training. Strawberry encouraging the crowd as if to say, come on, let me hear it. Carr at the plate. Born in San Bernardino. Carr has bounced around. He went from the Reds to the Mariners to the Mets before he was 20 years old. Right. He has never hit. That has slowed his development. Runs very well. Has stolen as many as 53 bases, but of course he has to get on. There goes the runner to third, and the throw, he's in there. So Konine is having a huge day. 4 for 4 and a stolen base at third. So Trilcheck forgot about him. And you notice how he brought his left leg up. It was a long delivery, and Konine steals it. You can't bring that leg up like that and hold a man on. Little ground ball to the right side. Reed will hold Konine and take care of Carr. So Chuck loses a chance for a run batted in. Two down, and Scott Pose coming up. Pose is 1 for 4.
Number 2, Scott Boone.
Pose made that wonderful catch on that shot by Jose Offerman. Jose must have hit it about 420 feet at least, and Pose ran it down. Fouled away. 0-1. Six runs, 14 hits for the Marlins. Three runs, seven hits, two errors for the Dodgers, and we're in the bottom of the eighth inning. The Marlins have led all the way, scored three in the second, and they have never been headed. 1-1. Trilcheck, who makes a good play to stay with it and almost threw it away. Karros made a fine play at the other end. No runs, a man left, and Brian Harvey will be coming in to pitch the ninth with the Marlins leading 6-3.
This is weird. It's great, but it's weird.
Super Lotto. It could happen to anybody.
I heard about it Saturday night. Next day I'm at the supermarket and it hits me. Like I could totally afford all this cheese.
Super Lotto. It could happen to anybody.
Where there's smoke, there's chicken. At Jack in the Box, we slowly smoke chicken breast and carve it into tender slices. And where there's smoked chicken, there's cheddar. Natural aged melting cheddar. Then we top it with sizzling bacon, all on grilled sourdough. The new smoked chicken, cheddar, and bacon sandwich at Jack in the Box. Where there's smoked chicken, there's
We thought we'd been everywhere. Seen everything. We were wrong.
We're bad to the bone.
These guys were weird. And we liked it. Later, they took us to the Tower of Bud. Brother, tomorrow we ride again.
6-3 in favor of the Florida Marlins as we go to the ninth inning. And Brian Harvey, who was 0-4 with the Angels last year, but you notice a good ERA. The year before was Harvey's big season. He had 46 saves and an ERA of 1.6. He came up with a sore right elbow, was left exposed to the draft, and the Florida Marlins picked him. Ryan has a dandy forkball, but when the elbow was bothering him, he couldn't throw it. And if he is healthy, he can be one of the tougher pitchers in relief in the game. It'll be Mike Piazza, Jody Reed, and then a hitter for Trilcheck. Harvey is the fifth Florida pitcher. Hough, Aquino, Klink, Carpenter, and now Brian. Piazza hit into a double play, flied to right, grounded to short. Ball one. In 1991, and that was Harvey's great year, right-handers hit just 172 against him. With the bad elbow, last year they hit 250. Two balls, no strikes. And even last year, in the month of April, he gave up one earned run and picked up six saves for the Angels. In there. Two and one to Piazza. Brian Harvey, born in Chattanooga, lives in Catawba, North Carolina. He'll be 30 years old in June. Three and two to Mike Piazza. 6-3 in favor of the Florida Marlins, and we're in the ninth inning. And pitch hit to right, sinking, and drops for the base hit. Junior Felix gets it in. So Mike Piazza, line drive single to right.
Second baseman, Jody Reed.
Jody Reed has struck out and twice single to left. Ball one. Dave Hansen is out on deck, swinging the weighted bat for the Dodgers. Two balls and no strikes. So the Dodgers have been trying to catch up all day and have failed. Now suddenly it's their last chance. Ninth inning, 6-3, Florida. Right. 2-1. Fly ball, but it's playable. Scott Pose is there. That's their first out in the ninth inning. And the batter now will be Dave Hansen. So Hansen off the bench. He hit only 212 during spring training. Doesn't have much of a chance to play. In fact, things had gotten so desperate for Dave, he was playing a little bit of first base. Ball one. Joe Malfitano certainly hasn't had very many visitors today. That's a strike. 1-1. It is all over at Wrigley Field, Chicago. Atlanta getting what you figure they're going to get. Fine pitching. And they beat the Cubs 1-0. Don't forget the post-game show. We'll have all the scores of all the other games plus an interview, so stay right with us. 2-1 the count to the pinch hitter, Dave Hansen. And another strike. Jose Offerman on deck. 6-3 Marlins, one out in the ninth. There's Jose. And there's a drive to right. Moving over for it. Almost running away from it is Felix. That ball seemed to slice. And Felix just did stay with it. So two out in the ninth inning. In the first game in Florida Marlin history. And this crowd on its feet. And Jose Offerman will be coming up. So many members of the crowd up and at them. And the Marlins one out away. Jose Offerman struck out and walked, singled, and then hit that 420-foot ball that was caught by Scott Pose in the seventh inning. Two out in the ninth. Piazza at first. They're not holding him. Strike. 1-1. Everybody up. It It has been a big day for the people in South Florida. It is a big moment now. One strike away. They're all out. Two and two. So deuces wild on Offerman. Two balls, two strikes, two out. Ninth inning. 6-3 Florida. The first win in Marlin history. We'll be back.
Why does the florist fill up at 76? And the landscaper? Why does the plumber keep on coming back? Well, owning businesses themselves, maybe they recognize a good product when they see it. Like great service and specially formulated gasolines. Maybe that's why so many businesses make it their business to pay us a visit. Unocal 76, where you find people who care about cars.
Do the little things on your airline work as well as they should? Before you get on an Alaska Airlines plane, we make sure everything is shipshape, inside and out.
The Marlins had a triple by Walt Weiss and a double by Orestes Destrada. The Dodgers had doubles by Eric Davis and Eric Karros and a home run by Tim Wallach. The winning pitcher, Charlie Hough, and the loser, Orel Hershiser. Once again, the final score, the Marlins 6, the Dodgers 3. For Don Drysdale and Ross Porter, this is Vin Scully inviting you to stay tuned for the postgame show coming right up. Dodger Baseball was brought to you in part by Budweiser, the king of beers, with that fresh, pure, natural taste. Nothing beats a Bud. By Farmer John, for the finest bacon, ham, sausage, hot dogs, luncheon meats, and fresh pork, Farmer John. By Unocal 76, where you find people who care about cars. And by your Southern California Lexus dealer, who invites you to test drive a Lexus today.
My brother, about to become a father.
So how big can a crib be? Season tickets went on sale today, Mike.
Yeah. Well, maybe next year.
You've gone 5 years straight.
Yeah.
Is this about the kid? This kid's getting for free, you know.
He's gonna be a little tight.
Mike, this year's on me.
Only one beer has the taste as genuine as the people who drink it. Budweiser.
Now, the new little guy's going to every game, right?
Bobby, it could be a girl.
A girl?
Takes off on a big fishing trip.
doesn't even invite me. So I go shopping. Hope he likes it.
Super Lotto. It could happen to anybody.
We knew something was up. The foreman wanted to see us right away. They say nobody wins the lottery? Oh, yeah?
Super Lotto. It could happen to anybody.
The new Lexus GS Luxury Performance Sedan.
It not only corners better than the BMW 535i, but it rides smoother. Of course, if you still insist on feeling every pebble in the road, be our guest. See the GS at your Southern California Lexus dealer. The price is within reach, too.
The Florida Marlins opened up Joe Robbie Stadium for business today, and when it was all over, the Marlins made it worthwhile and made their debut a success as they beat the Dodgers 6-3. Charlie Hough did it. He had said before the game he wanted this victory more than any other that he had ever wanted in his life, and he was able to beat Tommy Lasorda and the Dodgers. They had to pinch hit for Charlie Hough and take him out of the game, but he did give him six innings, and that was enough, finally getting to the ninth inning, and Brian Harvey nailed it down. For the Dodgers, they were down 3-0 at the end of the second inning, and they never could recover. Orel Hershiser suffering the defeat. There was one home run, that by Tim Wallach. He hit it upstairs to left field, but it still only counted for one run, and that was that. The Florida Marlins in the first day of the franchise, and they come up with a win, 6-3. One reason they did was a kid from Rialto, went to school at UCLA, Jeff Conine, who had four hits and a steal of third. He's our guest. Let's meet him and go to Don.
All right, Vin, thank you very much. Well, Jeff, I tell you, I couldn't think of a better way to break in as far as starting off in a new town, new franchise, 4-for-4. Everything went right for you.
Yeah, it did. I had a good day just basically going up there trying to make contact. I was a little bit nervous before the game, you know, new surroundings. The fans were really excited. The media was incredible. But calmed down after the first inning and had a good game.
What about the clubhouse prior to the game? I mean, was it the usual? And I've always maintained, Pee Wee Reese said, if you're not nervous opening day, there's something wrong with you. What about the clubhouse?
That's right. We were all nervous. A lot of the interviewers were asking questions about how our feelings were before the game. And with the media attention that we had, there was a lot of people that were a little bit more nervous than expected. Walt Weiss said he had a lot of butterflies in there.
You came over here, you're with a new franchise right now. Were you disappointed or were you happy?
Well, when I was first unprotected, when I found out I was unprotected, I was a little shocked. But after, you know, I got to realizing that it's a new opportunity for me to start in the big leagues, I was very happy.
When you talk about starting, of course, I looked at in your press guide, I see a pitcher. And I said, huh, what happened there?
Well, it was an odd story. One of our part-time scouts for the Royals was my pitching coach my freshman year at UCLA. And he thought that I had more pro potential as an infielder than I did as a pitcher. So after my junior year came around, he decided, what the heck, we'll put your name in for the draft and see what happens. And they ended up drafting me in the 58th round.
And, of course, now you're in the outfield here. I commented on the air. It looks as though this is not the easiest park to pick a ball up in the daytime.
It was difficult today. A lot of people wearing white in the background. The seats are a little bit reflective. So it's not a real good park to pick the ball up in.
Well, I'll tell you what, Jeff, you picked it up enough to get four hits this afternoon. Congratulations, a great start for you. Good luck the rest of the way.
Thank you very much, Don.
Okay, Jeff Conine, our guest, and we'll be back with more right after this.
Yourself out just getting to your flight. That's why at Alaska Airlines, we figured the least we can do is treat you well once you finally get here.
Fresh.
natural. Budweiser, king of beers.
When you were a child, you were told we're all created equal. But now that you're a little older, you see things a bit differently. The new Lexus GS luxury performance sedan. It's roomier, quieter, and rides smoother than cars costing thousands more. Maybe we are all created equal, but it doesn't have to stay that way. See your Southern California Lexus dealer for treatment that's unequaled.
The Florida Marlins made their opening day in the National League a happy as well as historic occasion as they beat the Dodgers 6-3. We can take a look at the scoreboard to get details on all the other scores, although we regret we do not have details because the ticker situation here at Joe Robbie has apparently broken down, but we do have scores. Montreal got its only run in the ninth inning. Cincinnati held on to beat him 2-1. The Mets are leading Colorado. They're going to the eighth inning, having scored single runs in the fourth, fifth, and sixth, and lead the Rockies 3-0. Atlanta got a run in the first inning, and that's all, and the Cubs got nothing, and at the end of it, Atlanta held on to beat Chicago 1-0. Philadelphia will be at Houston tonight. In the American League, Texas had a five-run third inning and went on to beat Baltimore 7-4. The Yankees had a five-run sixth inning and went on to polish off Cleveland 9-1 before a huge crowd. Boston had a three-run fifth inning, and they're leading Kansas City 3-1 in the bottom of the eighth inning. Detroit will be at Oakland tonight. We'll have the highlights of today's game right after this.
This is weird. It's great, but it's weird.
Super Lotto. It could happen to anybody.
I heard about it Saturday night. Next day I'm at the supermarket and it hits me. Like I could totally afford all this cheese.
Super Lotto. It could happen to anybody.
Where there's smoke, there's chicken. At Jack in the Box, we slowly smoke chicken breast and carve it into tender slices. And where there's smoked chicken, there's cheddar. Natural aged melting cheddar. Then we top it with sizzling bacon, all on grilled sourdough. The new smoked chicken cheddar and bacon sandwich at Jack in the Box. Where there's smoked chicken, there's
Florida Marlins beat the Dodgers 6-3 behind Charlie Hough. Orel Hershiser suffered the loss, and Brian Harvey got the save. Let's take a look at the highlights of the game. A good beginning for Charlie Hough and the Florida Marlins as Jose Offerman called out on strike. Then in the second inning, Walt Weiss tripled inside first all the way down into the right field corner. By the time Strawberry got it, Santiago and Conine had scored. Florida led 2-0. Scott Pose had a big day. He got a base hit to left field to score Weiss, and Florida led 3-0. Later on in the game, the Dodgers tried to come back. Jeff Reed singled to left field. That scored Karros. That made it 4-1 in favor of Florida. The Dodgers got a little bit closer when Jose Offerman got a base hit to right field. That scored Jeff Reed to make it Florida 4 and the Dodgers 2. The Dodgers really got close in the top of the sixth inning when Tim Wallach hit a monstrous home run in the upper deck. It hit the first row of the upper deck in left field, and that made it 4-3 Florida. However, Scott Pose followed that with a dazzling play in center field on a ball that was hit by Jose Offerman. It traveled estimated maybe 420 feet. To be honest, I didn't know Offerman could hit a ball that far. And Pose made the great catch, and that turned the Dodgers away. The Marlins added two more and went on to win it easily 6-3. Well, that's one. That's game one of 162. Tomorrow, we'll take a look at the pitching matchups. The Dodgers will come with Ramon Martinez trying to get him squared away. Martinez has had somewhat of a shaky start, and he'll draw his opponent, Jack Armstrong. Warm-up time at 4 and game time at 4:30. That'll do it for today. For Don Drysdale and Ross Porter, this is Vin Scully wishing you a very pleasant good afternoon from Joe Robbie Stadium in Miami, Florida, where the Marlins beat the Dodgers 6-3.
The season's fresh, and so's the catch of the day when the Dodgers go fishing for marlin. Tomorrow at 4:30, live on Channel 5.